Your class two, can you start?
Yeah, yeah, please.
Can you just start talking, yes? How many of the candidates here have got their own trichodont extracted tooth for the hands on? Four. Six. Is it an extracted tooth or trichodont?
Extracted
tooth. Okay, assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I welcome you all on behalf of Global Dental Professionals. We are invited and we are equally happy to see all the people getting together on a common platform and again coming and hearing to our dynamic speaker Dr. Hilal. To start off our program, I think I would like to call Dr. Asif. He would start with a sirat on a positive note, inshallah, followed by Dr. Imtiaz's small welcome speech, and inshallah we'll start as soon as possible the Hilal's program. Please, Dr. Asif, come forward.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم صدق الله العظيم
ما شاء الله جزاك الله خير دكتور أسد may Allah Ta'ala gift us and spread the knowledge given by Dr. Hilal amongst us and from us to the other doctors surrounding us. I would request Dr. Imtiaz sir to come on the stage. Dr. Imtiaz is a senior most clinician, alhamdulillah, serving the community at his best. And he is the managing director of Departmental Clinic. Sir, the dais is your house.
First of all, I'm really very delighted and happy. Alhamdulillah. Our faculty brothers have gathered here only a simple imitation. Birds of the same feather, they really flock together. Today's our gathering is to there to see that we become a better doctor, better skilled, with better knowledge and better experience. A doctor is a student for the lifetime. We should never forget. Anybody who thinks that I know everything, unfortunately, is the most unfortunate, deprived kind of person. A true doctor should always feel that I need to know more. Only then he will have the urge to learn, and he always try to become a better and better doctor. The moment if somebody starts feeling that I know everything, he ceases to learn, and literally, professionally, he will die. If I hear, I forget. If I see, I remember. But if I do it, I will know. Each one teach one. The best way to learn is to teach. We should never feel we try to be conservative and stingy as far as spreading the knowledge is concerned. We should always have the zeal and interest to see that we spread the knowledge, whatever it is. Learning is different from reading. Learning is actually different from reading. Swimming is learned, it's not read. And it's learned in an environment of water. And likewise, cycling is learned. It's not read. And it is learned in an environment of road. So the Gandhu practice is learned from seniors and more experienced heads. Experience is a goal. It's very unfortunate to know the fact that experience is a comb which is given to a man who has grown by. Only those very old kind of people, they'll have the treasure of experience, who have very little time to utilize their knowledge and experience. Like how, as far as learning is concerned, even if it is a person with less knowledge, a low profile man, we should not hesitate. Only such persons would be lucky and they'll really be benefited from the society. Like work of bandaging, as far as learn, bandaging is learned by orthopedic surgeons from wild boys. Like how we have repeatedly seen, even big architects, they learn from masons, from carpenters, and from plumbers. So we should never look down upon anybody as far as learning is concerned. Anybody has better knowledge than me, we should not hesitate or not shy away from learning. It is said by physicians that echocardiography is learned by cardiologists from echo technicians. So we should have no inferiority complex as far as learning is concerned. It is better to commit mistakes 100 times at the term of learning under the seniors, and than committing a mistake at the with the patient in your practice. Practice is an art, it's not a science. Knowledge and skills make only 20%. It's the soft skills in practice which make 80%. So we should have the human values, like we should have kindness, compassion, empathy, and should be inculcated and imbibed in our nature to be a successful practitioner. And we should always try to learn more and see that and next to none. My practice, because we practice on the human beings, any mistake done deliberately, rather ignorantly, will be a very big kind of offense, which will not be forgiven neither by the society nor by the creator. So we should always see to it that we serve in the best possible way what is available in the world, so that our patients get the best service from it. Thank you.
India's knowledge is ocean. That is what we are swimming into. Never hesitate. There is no bar, there is no creed, there is no gender. There is no superiority, there is no inferiority. Knowledge has no barriers. Everybody can learn with each other. As Einstein said, knowledge is equal to one by ego. That is, more the knowledge, lesser the ego. Lesser the knowledge, more the ego. So we should always remember that. So without wasting much of the time, I would like to call the dynamic Dr. Hilal. I think this gentleman doesn't need any kind of introduction. We had a full house last time on caste partials. Inshallah, today is Crown and Bridge revisited. I think why revisited is the biggest question now, because we, I think that word, I think Dr. Hilal would explain in detail. Please, Dr. Hilal, come on to the desk.
All have done at least few hundreds crowns, and there may be few practitioners who have done thousands crowns. Okay. To start with, I'll be starting with the basics of what is tooth preparation, what are the abutments, how do you select abutments, till the cementation procedure and also the crown removal procedure. To start with, what is the goal in dentistry? Basic goal, all of you, what you have in your mind is important. So basic is to see to it that the functioning dentition of the patient will have a long life. Similarly, like a medical profession will think of you living long, we also should think of the functional dentition being long. Okay? To strive for this, the goal in dentistry is to put in your knowledge, skill and all the resources at its command in both the maintenance and rehabilitation. So for such a view, most important is the scientific principles. Even though you might have skill, you have to invoke the principles in tooth preparation. So even though dentistry has been a skilled craft, but it is much more than that. We should also know not only how to do it, but also why we are doing it. So teeth preparations should always be done to restore with the crowns. So to have a successful treatment involved with the principles of preparation. So teeth always do not possess a regenerative capacity. Once you lose enamel or dentin, it is lost. It will not be regenerated like other tissues in the body. Okay? So it's usually lost because of caries or trauma, attrition. So fixed prosthodontic treatment can offer exceptional values for both the patient and the dentist. So when you evaluate it, you see these kind of prepared teeth which is unhealthy, unattractive, with poor function, which you can convert it into a dentition which enhances good occlusion, good mastication and also aesthetics. To achieve success, first, when the patient is coming to you, the careful diagnosis, clinical examination, and it is a must a radiograph for a FPD patient. Clinically, you may see a gingiva up to the cemento enamel junction clinically, but seeing the radiograph, you will definitely have some amount of bone loss. So the next will be once you finish with the diagnosis, radiographs, you go with the active phase of treatment. Active phase of treatment will be your preparations, your temporizations, and your final placement. So after that, you should also have a planned schedule or the follow-up care of the patient. So how, what are the reasons what you are treating for the tooth loss? The reasons can be aesthetics, can be functions, can be loss of vertical with the TMK problems or TMK dysfunction. There may be speech problem, and also there will be the maintenance of the dental. So where all you indicate a fixed partial denture? In a short span bridge, patient's options, having patient's preference that he needs fixed. Then you have, you should always have sound teeth adjacent to the edentulous spaces, and also in patients which are mentally compromised, wherein they are not able to maintain their removal partial dentures. Contraindications. Contraindications are large defects and young patients. Why you don't treat patients who are less than 16 or 14 years of age is because of a large pulp horns. Okay, you have long span bridges, it's a contraindicated. You have bilateral edentulous spaces or unilateral edentulous spaces with no distal abutments, it's also contraindicated. And you also have congenital malformed teeth which do not offer adequate support. So this case, how will you treat? Anyone can tell me. If you come across a case of this which has a large ridge defect, how will you treat it? Anyone can guess. Even if it is wrong, it's okay. How will you treat it? How will you treat this large defect? Can you give a canine to canine bridge with metal till here or the porcelain, gingival porcelain, and then do a bridge? No, we can't do. What we can do? We can't. We have to do only RPD here. RPD. Anyone else? Any other guesses? Bone graft, yeah, ridge augmentation procedure. You have to wait for the patient, then do it. So in these cases, you have to wait at least for 6 months or 8 months after ridge augmentation and do it. So basically these cases, if your ridge is very thin and patient not willing for a ridge augmentation, what you will do? How will you treat? Anyone heard of Andrew's bridge? Andrew's bridge, it's a fixed removal. So how it is done is, you can see here, it's a canine to canine bridge with a header bar. Can you see? Canine to canine bridge is done with a header bar. Over this will be a clip-on removal denture. It's a fixed removal type of bridge which is based, used in large bony defect cases wherein you can treat very successfully doing this.
Andrew's bridge, is
it? Andrew's. Okay. So everyone know, anyone can guess what is the survival rate of your bridges, what you are doing in your practice. Anyone has an idea? You do a bridge, patient asks you definitely, you know, how many years will it come? Patients definitely ask you how many years it comes. So what will you tell? 5 years, 10 years? 12 years, depends on how you maintain. These are all your answers. So what is, anyone can guess how many years it is? So there are studies done on the, by meta-analysis, okay, which says that your one third is 33% of the cases require replacement by 15 years. So you should know now that your prosthesis should come to 15 years means how good you should do it. 33% after 15 years. Okay, so every restoration what you are doing should withstand your occlusal forces. Any restoration, let it be a filling, let it be a crown, let it be a bridge, let it be an implant. Okay. So in FPDs, abutments bear the stresses of mastication, and the choice of abutment influences the prognosis of your treatment. Okay, what all are the factors that influence abutment selection? So first is the crown length. How much should be a crown length basically? Minimum for a restoration. After preparation, the occluso gingival height, that is from the marginal ridge to the gingiva, margin of the gingiva should be minimum should be 4 mm. If it is less than 4 mm, what will happen? Every other day he comes to you, irritates and tells you, please cement it, please. So every other day is coming back to you telling that loss of retention. And if it's a posterior teeth, you have to be very careful. There are chances he can swallow also. Okay. So always see to it that, suppose your height is very less, you can always increase your height by what? By doing what? You can do a gingival lengthening procedure or you can do a subgingival finisher. These two are the options basically. If your tooth is not erupted, it is slightly submerged, you can always take a help of an orthodontist, pull your teeth down. A crown root ratio, most important factor. What is the crown root ratio? So it is the physical relation of the teeth which is outside, what is seen to your eyes, okay, in the bone, not clinically. So physical relation of the teeth which is outside the bone and the physical relation of teeth which is inside the bone. So and clinical situation is different. What you see clinically cannot, may not be same in the radiograph. So you have to evaluate with the radiograph the crown root ratio. Here is the biomechanical concept. So the concept is simple. The crown portion here will be the effort arm and the root portion will be the resistance arm. So the junction where your bone starts will be the point of force, sorry, point of rotation, center of rotation. So at this point, suppose your effort arm increases, your resistance arm decreases. You are able to understand what I am telling you. If your effort arm increases, your root portion support decreases. So this condition leads to a disastrous case. So the support on your root arm is decreasing, your forces of rotation will be increasing. So ideal crown root ratio is 1:2, or some books say 2:3. So the ratio of crown root ratio, the crown portion should be less than the root portion comparing to the periodontal ligament. Okay? And optimum is 1:1.5 and minimum should be 1:1. So periodontal ligament area or the pericemental area, it is the area which covers the root to the bone. Attachment of your tooth to the bone with the periodontal ligament area. The larger the area, you have better support. That is, your molars will have more pericentable area when you compare to your incisors. So, so if there is a periodontal disease, there is always loss of the supporting bone, which leads to lesser capacity to serve as an abutment. So everyone knows anti-slough. So the pericemental area of your abutment should always be more or equal to the pericemental area of the teeth to be replaced. Okay. The validity of anti-slough is only applicable in cases there is short span bridges. If there are long span bridges, your anti-slough will not have validity. Average root surface area. So if you see maximum average pericemental area is found to be in the maxillary molars. Okay. Then comes the mandibular molars, then the canines, then premolars, then the incisors. Lowest is in the mandibular incisors and maximum is in the maxillary molars. So what are the factors? See, there are certain factors which you might have to modify while you are selecting and doing a bridge. So in case you have bone loss in the periodontal ligament, in the teeth which you are going to use as abutments, you always might have to modify by increasing the number of abutments. For an example, you have two missing teeth, you are taking two abutments as 4 unit bridge, connecting it into 2+2 as 4 unit bridge. Though at that time what you will do, you will see the pericemental area. Sometimes it may be equal, sometimes it may be less. So if it is less, you will be adding a extra teeth to increase the pericemental area so that you will have a long lasting bridge. Mesial tilting or distal tipping, this is seen more in mandibular molars. Molar is missing, maxillary first molar is missing, you have drifting of your mandibular molar. So your angulation or the forces will not be falling to the long axis after you are placing the bridge. So you might have to increase in those cases also. These are all modification to the anti-slough. Okay? If you have migration and there is decrease in the space of the pontic, then you need not increase the number of abutments. Okay? If you have forces, opposing forces with heavy occlusal forces in cases of bruxers, patients like bruxers or patients who have high muscular activity, you will have to again increase the number of abutments. If you have endodontically treated teeth with periodontally compromised, yes, again you have to increase the number of abutments. Okay? So you have arch situation where you are creating greater leverage. Which is an arch situation where you have greater leverage? Anyone can guess? Arch situation, which part of the arch will have greater leverage?
Canine
has the greater leverage. That is when you are replacing the maxillary anteriors. When you have 4 pontics and you are using 2 canine abutment, you have greater leverage because your pontic area acts as a lever. There were two people, scholars, Neyman and Erickson, who were against the anti-slough or they were anti-anti-slough. These two people always used to say that even though there is pericemental area, there is equal, not more, not needed. They used to tell pericemental area, even if it is less, you can always do a bridge or a fixed prostal on this. their concept was, even if it is less than half of the replaced teeth, they have done studies which showed there was no bone loss for 8 to 11 years. So these conditions will be applicable even in our practice, where we do not follow Antti's law, is in the cross arch bridges or cross arch stabilization. For an example, you have two canines, then one premolar on either side, then a molar on either side. You will try applying to do a 12 unit single bridge. So suppose you see in these areas, you are definitely not following the Antti's law. You are breaking the Antti's law and doing like how Neymar and Ericsson say, even Antti's law. So in these cases, what is the advantage is, you are getting a cross arch stabilization, you are splinting all the teeth, means interconnecting all, and your stress distribution is evenly distributed. Root configuration. So always canine has a thickness in the labiolingual. It's more thicker, more longer. The perisymmetry, it's a better abutment when you compare to incisor. When it comes to molars, multi-rooted, divergent roots are better roots than roots which are fused or conical. Even in molars, you find certain roots like third molar, second molar, you sometimes find closer conical roots and fused roots. They are not very good abutments when you compare to teeth which have divergent. Okay, periodontal diseases. Healthy periodontal tissue is a prerequisite for all your fixed restorations. Occasionally there may be some amount of plague what everyone will have, so that will not hamper your periodontal or leave to periodontal destruction. Abutment with bone loss needs careful assessment. So whenever you find a case where there is bone loss, where there is recession, you always have to carefully examine why that is happening. Maybe it is a wrong brushing technique. Maybe there may be a lot of amount of calculus deposit, okay, plague, calculus, oral hygiene of the patient. So always you have to see that you treat the underlying cause before you selecting that as abutment. Treat it and do. So if you have redness, if you have swelling of the gingiva, you have to take a perio opinion, do the periodontal work, clear all the, bring back the gingival tissue into a healthy condition, then only go with the prosthesis. Mobility, everyone knows the classification grade 1, 2 and 3, where you have less than 1 mm, more than 1 mm, and then you never take an abutment which is grade 3 mobile, which has a vertical and also horizontal. Please do not take those because they will lead to failure. So if it is grade 1 or 2, you can always take it by treating the undercross, splinting it, bringing back to a stable condition and then use it as an abutment. Furcation involvement, class, this also has a four classification, class 1 being an early lesion where there is a supra bony pocket, but radiographically you will not be able to find any lesion. When it is 2 and 3, yes, radiographically you find a lesion. In grade 3 you have recession, okay, grade 4 is a complete tunnel which you can see, you are not indicated. Suppose you are taking grade 2 and 3 as abutments, you might have to undergo a procedure called as tunneling, where you then grafting procedure or hemisection. Suppose you are doing hemisection, how will you restore it? Any idea what can be done? If you do hemisection, anyone has a telescopic crowns? Telescopic crowns, anyone have? So when you do a hemisection, you should always use a telescopic crown. Telescopic crown is like a telescope. It's a crown over crown, which I'll be showing you later. You can just see how it is done. Okay, long axis. Always your teeth which is straight or parallel to the long axis, it's always better because periodontal ligament takes the stresses which are perpendicular to that, which are placed horizontal, which are onto the occlusal surfaces. Okay, if you have inclined teeth or restored, you can use it in a short span bridges. Okay, so if there is a tilting of the molars, okay, if it is less than 25 degrees, what you have to do? If it is more than 25 degrees, what you have to do? I will be telling. So in resin bond, everyone knows what are resin bonded prosthesis. I told you in children who are less than 14 years or 16 years, you can try doing this kind of prosthesis. And this resin prosthesis, you know what, it can be used only in a single missing teeth, especially in the anterior area, maxillary or mandibular. In this prosthesis, you will be preparing only the lingual surface area for a metal retainer. It will have two metal wings on the abutments with a single point. Are you able to understand what I am telling you? I will show you that later. Just I am telling you basics. This can be used as a prosthesis in patients who are young. Okay, what are the bending or the deflection forces? The basic concept, if there is only one pontic, okay, the forces what they are falling, pontic is this, forces are transferred onto the abutments. So it is always said that your length of the edentulous span and your occluso-gingival thickness of the pontic is the forces what fall will be the cube type. Suppose you have three missing teeth, it is three pontics, it is 3 × 3 × 3, that is the force or the bending forces are about 27 times. If you have two pontics, then it is 8 times. That I will show you next. So how it acts?
You said the bending forces,
yeah,
bending related to default whatever kind of the material used in the,
yeah, pitch. See, basic alloy what we are using is a nickel chrome, generally practiced. Before they used to use gold also, but nowadays what we practice basically is a nickel chrome or it may be a zirconium. So the forces whatever is falling will have some amount of deflection. Nickel chrome has a highest yield strength. That's the reason we use, and it also bonds well with the ceramic. Bonding of nickel chrome alloy because of the release of oxides when it is tempered is better bonding with the ceramic. So basically we are using nickel chrome. Cobalt is used rarely, but it is more used in a cast partial denture compared to none because of its strength. Okay, in cases of secondary abutments, what I told you, I showed you before this where the deflection forces are more. Here what we have is the secondary abutment. So always when you are using a secondary abutment, whenever the forces are falling on your pontic area, the forces are falling, transferred on the primary abutments, then to the secondary abutments. So primary abutments act as a lever. So always whatever you are taking, secondary abutment also should have enough retention, enough occluso-gingival length. You cannot take short cross, so the forces what will be falling will be lifting the prosthesis. So here while it is slightly lifting, patient may complain it is moving, but you will tell, no, no, it's okay, it is firm. Because here you will not be able to remove it. Slight movement here will be a site for foci, for the plane, foot debris, and then digging. So always whatever secondary abutment means should have full support till the margin. So arc curvature, what I told you, inter-abutment axis. So when you are replacing your maxillary anterior with a 6 unit bridge, everyone will do a 6 unit. Anyone has done 8 unit till date? Anyone has done? No one does. Because of lack, you think canine is a very good abutment. If I do a 6 unit, patient will be very happy and he will not come back. So basically here what is happening is, when these 4 are pontics, it lies outside the inter abutment axis of all these teeth. So the lever forces are more. So the torque on the canine is more. So once this stop, to neutralize this stop, you have to increase, means you have to take either side premolar to decrease the lever forces what are falling on your pontic area. I have also personally not seen any person doing a 8 unit bridge in the anterior, because everyone planned to do a 6 unit thinking canine is a teeth which has very good angle. But technically and scientific principles, it's better to use a 8 unit. So occlusal anatomy. What is nature's own anatomy? You always have the cusp, the grooves, the fissures that always has to be included in your ceramic or in the crown restoration what you are doing. So the advantage of having those fissures is the sharpness and the shearing forces will have minimum contact if you have cusps and slopes. If it is flat, the forces what are falling will be more. If you have the cusps and slopes, you always have the forces being distribute. So what are the factors on the occlusal forces? Basically will be the degree of muscular activity. Which patients will have more muscular activity? Patients who use it more will have more muscles or the more muscular activity. So bruxers will have a higher muscular activity, or patient who is well built will also have higher muscular activity. And the number of teeth that are replaced, the leverage on the bridges, and adequacy of bone support. All these should be evaluated as the factors that are onto the forces what they are falling. Result, if there are excessive forces, how to evaluate? You will basically, no one is going to evaluate his muscle is strong, his masticate. You just see it's edentulous, you're trying to do a bridge to the patient. But no one is overseeing what. So only when the patient comes back to you with a chipped off ceramic or a fractured piece, or regularly getting it removed, even though you have adequate crown length, with the crowns, then you will always think over ki what could be the reason that patient is coming back with the loose prosthesis. Width of the pontic. So always when you are doing, you never select the width of the pontic. Your technician or your technician or the person is the one who is going. So always you have, after he does it, or you can always instruct him that your pontic width should always be less than the width of your abutment. It should not be more than the width of your abutment. Your pontic should not be bigger. It should be smaller. Let it be mesiodistally, let it be upper. Endodontically treated teeth. So always whiter teeth are best preferential for a crown and bridge. Suppose teeth is involving pulp, you definitely have to do a root canal. And if it is more destructed, that is you don't have two walls, the crown structure, remaining crown structure is very less, which is less than 40%, you always advocate a post-encore and then only use it as an abutment. So anyone does cantilever bridges? No one does cantilever? Anyone does cantilever? No one. So it's outdated, but still people practice cantilever. If you have a single central missing, they always make other central with the wing on the lateral. Behind they just make a metal ring or something like a rest on the lateral. So doing this, what will happen? Yes, this will go for RCT. The lateral will definitely go for a root canal. One, the other option here also you will find interproximal decay. It is not immediate, maybe a few years, maybe a year, maybe a 2 years. So always it's better to do a full veneer crowns. Age of the patient, I spoke about it. So just to brief, why we are not doing this, because of the large pulp horns. There are other options where you can maintain the periodontal spaces by giving a removable partial denture or using a space maintainer or doing minimal tooth preparation. Tilted molars. So most of us come across these kind of cases. So in tilted molars, the problem will be here. So once it is tilted, you prepare your teeth. Once you prepare your teeth, you send it to lab with the impression. He'll send a crown also, but that will not fit. What you'll do, you'll try to trim here, try to trim inside of the tissue, or try to trim the inside of the crown, or you try to trim the proximal area of your retainer so that it fits in. So always the problem here arises because of the path of placement. So always whenever you are placing, your path of placement should be parallel. That is, you should be able to easily place it and easily retrieve it. It's not that metal is so soft that you press it and it will go like a temporary or an acrylic crown. It will not go into the and sit on your margins. So always it is better to slightly restore your mesial surface of the molar, like enamoplasty, before you sending it to the lab. So once you do this, and you might have to reduce more on, slightly more on the mesial side. Because of the tilt, you will have occlusally making it parallel. Once you do this, then you will not have any problem or hindrance in placement. So if it is too excessively tilted, what you can do is, one option is, you have more than 25-30 degrees, then you can always take the help of orthodontist, remove the first, extract the third molar. Then upright your second molar. Then you can go for the prosthesis. Okay, if the tilt is less than 25 to 30 degrees, anyone does 3/4 crowns? I don't think no, anyone will do 3/4 crowns. So always you can do 3/4 crowns in mesially tilted teeth with less than 25 to 30 degrees. We have excellent result with these kind of prosthesis also. Here will be a fill veneer crown, premolar is full. Your molar which is tilted, you do the mesial half, means you will not be touching the distal. You are not going to cut or prep the distal area. It's only till the marginal ridge, and then you might have to give two proximal grooves on either side for retention. So telescopic crowns. These are used in cases of non-parallel abutments. Means you have abutments which are not parallel, you might have to prepare it. Give a metal coping crown, over that you will do a ceramic bridge. It's not that directly you do a bridge. So this is, I told you now, in hemisection cases, you always have to go for a telescopic crown and then crown. Anyone has done this kind of prosthesis? Telescopic crown. No? It's a very good prosthesis. Anyone can try if you have 4 or 5 abutments, okay, which have good periodontal support. You can try doing fixed removable prosthesis. This is a removable prosthesis, not a fixed, but using this, you will have much stability and patient also will have good masticatory efficiency in this case, because you are intercorrecting all this, cross stabilizing, and the support also is good with the patient. So don't think that this will be non-retentive, it will be very retentive. Metal to metal contact, the retention will be good. You can use these kind of prosthesis. You are using telescopic crowns well when you have non-parallel abutments. Okay, and you can use it in hemisection teeth. You have to use it in hemisection teeth. Over that, you will be doing the crown.
So you mean to say the individual tooth are crowned individually?
These are individually crowned, like metal copings.
Metal copings.
Yeah, individually crowned. All are individually crowned. This will have a slight mesh correction. These are ceramic crowns, metal with ceramic veneer. These are the crowns which will sit on all these copings.
So taking this as a vital tooth, the cutting would be more than what it is to be expected, because you have dual crowns now.
You will have dual, but what thickness you have with this is very less. You will have about 0.3 or 0.4 or maximum 0.5. The metal coping thickness will be very less. So it will not accommodate much, but usually see an opposing, you have a denture, wherein you have provision to do these kind of cases where you have few teeth, but your abutments are sound without any periodontal problems. You can definitely use these as a good abutments. I have done few cases with excellent results.
You recommend to do intentional RCTs for these kind of
if cases? Needed. See, if it is pulpally involved, you can do it. If it is not involved, you can always have a coping over it. See, the copings will have slight margins over which this will sit. The margins of the copings will give your margins of your restorations fit. It is not on the tooth. It will sit on the coping one.
Why this removable kind? Why it can't be fixed?
It can be fixed. See, what condition here is, you have a span length from here to here. Means from a third molar or a second molar till the canine. The span length is 2 months. So in these cases, the torque or the forces will be more. But basically what we will do is a full arch bridge. What we plan to do or hesitate to do, thinking that best is bridge, we will do a full bridge. But if the abutments are not parallel, one is cross, one is... So in those cases, you can use in non-parallel abutments. That is what I tell you. Non-parallel abutments, in hemisection teeth, you always advocate telescopic crown.
Are they the nickel chromium?
Yeah, nickel chromium. All metal what we use is nickel chromium. Only if patients, some ladies, they are prone to have allergy, that you might have to test. Otherwise, there is no problem with the nickel.
Frequent removing, placing.
Yeah, nothing will happen. See, it's a metal-metal junction. Nothing will happen to the metal-metal junction.
The tooth?
Yes.
Is it unstable?
No, nothing will happen. See, here forces are broken. It's like, it acts like a stress breaker. You have fixed and removable will always act as a stress breaker. So your abutment life actually increases in case you're doing a stress breaker. I'll show that in the next.
Sir, why it is suggested for hemisection?
Because you will have lost half of the root, no? So to make it intact and make it strong, we always give a telescopic crown. When you section your teeth, your crown shape, all that will not be aligned. So to make it parallel, we have to make it. So like in an old denture also, you always give a metal coping. That is just to keep the teeth intact.
So what about the margins?
Margin, I told you, no? Margins, you will have margins on your copings.
Okay, on the copings.
On the copings. These margins sit on the teeth, the coping margins sit on the margins of the teeth, these margins sit on the margins of the coping. So there is no, this doesn't have contact anything with the teeth. Okay? It's metal to metal contact.
So it should be used like a denture.
Yeah, something like a denture. But the efficiency is good. Because you have natural teeth supporting down, you will definitely have masticatory efficiency very high when you compare to these kind of teeth. See, non-rigid correctors. What are these abutments called? Everyone knows. In any event, what is this? What is the type of abutment this is? What is it called as? Anyone heard? Pyre abutment. So abutment which has edentulous space on either side, it is called as a pyre abutment. So where are the stresses falling? I showed you, no? Bending forces, deflection forces. So where are the forces falling? It's falling on this premolar. Maximum forces. So what you have to do is you have to break the stress. To break the stress, what you have to do? You have to use a non-rigid connector. Till now what we are speaking is all rigid connectors. Now I am talking about non-rigid connectors. You have tenon mortise, you have cross pin and wing. I think you can go back to UG days, you can remember certain things. So in this case what we are doing is, here we will do a 3-unit bridge with a proximal box which act as a keyway. And these 2 units which will have key. So you cement this first, then cement this. So when you are cementing this non-rigid connectors, the advantage of non-rigid connectors is they act as a stress breaker. Similarly, even in a mesially different molars also, you can use non-rigid connectors which are called as tenon mortise. Tenon and mortise. Tenon is the male part and mortise is the female part. So you always have to interconnect, to be interconnect and cement in a mesially tilted molars. Tooth preparation. So what is tooth preparation? So you prepare the enamel, the dentine and the cementum to receive the restoration is nothing but the tooth preparation. So everyone know components of a fixed partial denture. What is an abutment? What is a retainer? What is a connector? Connector connects pontic to the retainer. Retainer will be cemented on the abutment. Okay. Pontic is a missing tooth which replaces the lost, which replaces the missing teeth and also restores the form, function and aesthetics. So principles in tooth preparation. What are the principles? Everyone know. Preservation, retention form, resistant form, structural durability, marginal integrity, the periodontium. So I'll just basically brush. So that was according to Schillenberg. This is according to Rosenstiel. He classified into 3 different types: biological, mechanical and aesthetic. So biological being the conservation of the tooth structure, supragingival finish line, harmonious occlusion. Mechanical is the same, retention form and the resistance form. Aesthetics, it's more of porcelain, less of metal. Okay. So biological consideration we will discuss. So what are the consideration in biology? What you have to do? You have to take care of your cheeks, your lips, tongue. These are the soft tissue. You have to be very careful. One, you have to carefully retract all this. So whenever you are doing a proximal preparation, what you will end up doing? What you will do? You will automatically prepare or you should not prepare? You automatically prepare what? Adjacent teeth, rub it, leave it, what is there, enamoplasty, nothing will happen. So it always, the roughness on this adjacent abutment teeth leads to a point wherein you are attracting your bacteria. So it always you have seen as decay. Any patient comes with a breath, adjacent teeth pain, it is because of the this thing or space in your processes with inter-abutment teeth. So always you have to be very careful. So what can you do to avoid it? What will you do to avoid this? Yeah, you can use a metal strip. Any other option?
Separators
that you have to place one day prior or you place on the same day?
One or two days.
So patient will manage to tolerate that pain and come back to you for preparations. So usually it's not advisable. So basically what happens here is to tell you, you can use a thin bar, interproximal. Okay, and what you have to do in these cases is always the thickness of the enamel in the interproximal area is small. So when you are preparing it, leave a lip of enamel or fin of enamel while preparing it, which is in contact, that is the contact point. You leave some amount of enamel, then don't try to prepare close to this. You leave some space and then, so you will not be damaged. Suppose you touch it or damage, you always better you polish it or smooth it. So what are the temperature? So always you always have water in your aorta, or without water also you will be prepared. So always have water because it's a coolant which prevents any further purple pulp damage. Okay. So it always coolant should be used. What are the chemical and the bacterial actions? Chemical actions can be because of your cements what you are using. So always anyone has done a case, you do a good crown, patient comes back next day telling severe. Everyone who is practitioners will definitely have come across at least a few cases by now that patient come back telling severe pain, remove the bridge. You would have not slept whole night also. So that kind of things, how will you manage? it, we'll give a painkiller, give antibiotics, tell him use it for 2 days and then come back. See, so basically if pain is manageable, it will subside in a day or two. If it's too high, that means what preparation you have done, you have prepped more of dentine, which where your dentine tubules are open, which leads a severe pain, kind of pain after you have used glass ionomer, which has the polyacrylic acid, which irritates it. So always when you prepare these kind of teeth, it's always advisable to apply a bonding agent or a varnish onto the surfaces of the teeth. So if it is very severe, there is no option. You have to go for a root canal. So this, you will, everyone would have seen these kind of cases. And if the break is no more, I think all of you will lose the interest of the break. So we just start up. So everyone got a brief idea about your abutment selection and how to attain your retention and the resistance form in a crown preparation. So full mouth crown preparation, full metal. How will you do a metal crown preparation? Everyone have done metal crown preparation. So though there is not much to teach about it, but I'll just go through the steps briefly where you go wrong. Okay, when you are doing an occlusal preparation, so burst what you are using is always a round end, tapered, straight fissure burr. So whenever you are learning or you are doing, initially, you will not have an idea that you are reducing 1 mm, you are reducing 1.5 or reducing 2 mm. So that will be a basic confusion when you are doing preparing. So what you do is, you have this burr, you make indentation grows in your fissures. So once you make grows, make it on the buccal side, make it also on the lingual side. Something like this. Use it, make your grows. So once you make grows, how much? You take the width of this burr. Easy, you cannot measure in that area. You have prepped 1 mm or 1.5, it's a confusion. So the width of the burr is there, you dip it half. Half of your burr, you dip. So once you dip it half, it will be approximately close to 1 mm once you finish it. You're able to understand what I'm telling you? So once you make this fissure, you prep it on one side. Don't prep it on both the sides. Now you have done this grooves on the buccal and also on the lingual side. You start preparing your buccal side. Once you prepare your buccal side, what happens? You get a step there. So you will be able to see that step, how huge it is. So like how you climb the steps, you know it is equal or more. So once you prepare on one side, you will be able to see that there is a step on the other. So you remove the step, then it becomes even on both the sides. Everyone understand what I'm telling? So basically you start when you're doing, you will automatically get 1 mm. Easily 1 mm of clearance in between. So when you're doing next step, will be your functional cusp level. How will you attain functional cusp level? Any idea anyone knows? Anyone does functional cusp level, to be frank?
Yeah.
Everyone does? Very good. I have seen most of them don't do functional cusp level. So how you are going to do it is, you are using the same burr, you keep it 45 degrees angulated and functional cusp, the upper mandibular buccal cusps and maxillary palatal cusp. You have to run at a long axis 45 degrees. So if you have, this is your cusp, 45 degrees, you prepare about 1 to 1.5 mm. That will act as a functional cusp. By doing this, what you are doing, you are reducing your stress concentration. So whatever I'll be talking now is interrelated to what I've already spoken. So once you finish with this, then you can always use what, your utility wax. Keep it, ask the patient to bite with slight jerking or jiggling. Slight amount of jiggling. Don't just only bite, slight amount of it. So once you take out from it, you can use a wax caliper. If you have perforations, complete perforation, that means you have not reduced enough. What is enough for a metal cup? So you can use a wax caliper and measure. So always you should have minimum of 1.1 mm to 1.2 mm for a metal on a non-functional. If it is on the functional cusp side, that is mandibular buccal and maxillary palatal, you should have 1.5 mm of clearance. Then you will come with the buccal side of preparation. So So similarly here also, if you are learning, you can always make depth orientation grooves, then join it. Do half and then do the other half. Similarly, you run it buccally, you run it lingually. Once you reduce both buccally and lingually, same here also you have to prep around 1.2 to 1.5 mm. So prepare on either side. Then comes the interproximal area that I have told you how you have to avoid your damage to your adjacent teeth, that is more important. Here you use a tapered fissure burr when you are doing the interproximal. Always your burr should be parallel to the long axis of the tooth. Don't tilt either ways and try to do preparation. Once you complete your preparation, always the final will be, what will you do with the final preparations? Whenever you are preparing the interproximal, once you finish it, please do not damage your adjacent. If you damage your adjacent, you have to smooth on it or polish it. Keep that in mind. So once you finish with the interproximal, then you do the final finishing. So always you use a, for the finishing of the finish line, you have to use a chamfer or chamfer cutting burr, which is also called as a torpedo burr, which will be having a triangular edge. It will be triangular at the tip. So that your finish line will be created, so that your metal crown what comes merges with the margin. How your finish line will look, I'll show you further in the picture.
This is a carbide burr?
Which, see, carbide or a diamond, you can use either for preparation. There is no role you use, but basically carbide bursts are more expensive. We, most of us use diamond. So again, if you take burrs, you have different gradations on that. You have blue strip, you have red strip, you have green strip. So yellow is the polishing. The more the coarse is green. So basically we normally use diamond cutting with blue strip if it is money. If you go for Shofu, if you go for other Oreco, they all come in a standard sizes and diamond strips. They all are diamond.
What should be the width of the finish line? Width of the finish line.
Width of the finish line can be about 1 to 1.2 mm. See, basically here it will not be width. When it is a chamfer, it will have a sloping edge. That I'll show you when I'm showing the finish line. It will not be like a shoulder which you will have a right angle. It will be obtuse, about 60 degrees. So it merges with your ginger, with the ginger margin if you're doing equi ginger, or a supra ginger if you're doing a supra ginger. So finally you place the sitting grooves. Where you place the sitting grooves and why you place the sitting grooves? Anyone place sitting grooves? Anyone does sitting grooves? No one does sitting grooves. So sitting grooves are always placed on your functional cusp on the buccal side. It should be about 0.5 or 1 mm above your finish line. Okay, you have the straight fissure burr, you just make an indentation. Half of your burr inside onto the buccal, on the buccal side. So what it helps in?
Retention.
Can help in retention. Basically, it helps you position your crown. So positioning of your crown, your restoration, it helps. Perfect, it will work. So even if you have slight error in the inner surface of your restoration, it will not see. So that is the advantage here. Maybe retention, definitely it may help you. And also it may help you in the more the surface area, more the retention. So what all preparations you have done, like you are reducing the functional cusp, what it is giving you, all give you the features of the principles of tooth preparation. Your parallelism, what it is giving you, retention in the resistance form. Your thickness here, the functional cusp gives you the structural durability. Okay, your margin gives you marginal integrity. So all that should be smooth and so all preparations are similar when you are doing all posteriors molars. So except the seating groove, in the molar where you will place if you are doing a maxillary molar, seating groove? You have to place it on the palatal side, in the center. Metal ceramic restoration. How will you do metal ceramic? It's same procedure of preparation, only the amount of reduction is more and the finish line is different. So what you will do first, before you start, you can always make a diagnostic task and a putty index. Anyone does or no one does putty index. So putty index can be used when you are learning. So once you learn, you can do a putty index which helps you to do a temporization. That how to do, I'll tell you. So once you make a putty index, basically you are doing putty index just to evaluate the amount of preparation what you have done after the preparation. So index is done before the preparation. Once you make the index, you can cut it. One, you can cut it horizontally or you can cut it vertically. Adjacent to the teeth what you have prepared. So here, incisors, whenever you are preparing, first what you prepare is the incisor layers. So about 2 mm, you can make grooves if you are learning. If you are already learned, you can directly prepare. Labial, it has to be very important. It's a biplanar reduction. Biplanar reduction means you have to do incisal half, then do the gingival half. Don't try to prepare your incisors flat, like keeping a flat paper diamond work. Here you use a flat end, not a round end. So incisor reduction, follow. Then the labial reduction, incisal half, then the gingival half. When you are doing incisal half means only this much half you have to prepare. The other half later, the gingival half later. Similarly, you prepare incisal half, then the gingival half. Why you are doing this? You know? Shape of your incisor. If you not do that, I will tell you what will happen next. So same way you prepare the gingival half. What type of finish line you give Pakkali for a metal ceramic?
Shoulder.
Any other finish line you can give? Radial shoulder is for metal. What is radial shoulder? Someone has called radial shoulder. What is radial shoulder? Here has heard of radial shoulder? So radial shoulder, what you do is you bevel the internal line angle of the shoulder. That is radial shoulder. So one more type of shoulder, if you should bevel the margin? Shoulder with bevel also can be given. Shoulder with bevel, what is the advantage? You are going to remove what? What you are going to remove? You are going to remove the unsupported enamel. So once you finish with the labial reduction, then always see what happens if you don't follow the biplanar reduction. You can see this image. So this is a biplanar reduction. Here you are doing flat. Straight you are keeping a bar and straight line. How you do the buckle of a posterior. Similarly, if you are doing an incisor labially, you don't have enough space for the ceramic incisor. If you follow the contour to give more space for the incisor in this angle, you will end up exposing your pulp or you go very close to it. So you have to avoid both of this and go for only biplanar reduction. So lingual also, when you are learning, you can always take a round burr, make two or three indentations, use a wheel-shaped burr or a, what other burr you can use for singular? Or the flame-shaped burr. You can use either of it. Reduce the cingulum, then reduce the, then do your cingulum finish line. So once you are using this, always you have two options in metal ceramic. You can prepare wings. We don't prepare wings. Everyone know what a wing preparation is? You have heard of it? Interproximal, if you can carefully observe here, you can see there will be slight amount of projection amount. So we call it as a wing type of preparation, basically known, most of us don't do it. Okay, I'm just telling because I'm talking about theoretical aspect. Then you can always use a chamfer cutting bar here, again the torpedo bar. Why? What type of finish line you are giving palatally? For metal ceramic you are giving a chamfer. Only buccally in metal ceramic you are doing shoulder. When it comes to palatally, again you are doing a chamfer to the palatal and the interproximal. So again the finishing bar you can use, smoothen it, and main end what you use here is a for the shoulder. What do you use for the shoulder? What bar you use to create or finish the shoulder? So we use a end cutting bar. So what is the speciality of end cutting bar is, it has only the cutting efficiency here. This all it's just plain. Even if this surface contact here, nothing will happen. None of your teeth will get damaged. Only the preparation will be to the finish line. Then what you have done first, you remember a putty index. Come and place it back here. So then you can yourself appreciate the amount of preparation you have done is ideal or not. Is it enough? Not enough. Where you are short, where you are. Over prepared also you can, no? Under prepared also you can. So if you under prepare, what will happen? Under prepare, what will happen to your crown? You know, suppose you are placing one central, you do the preparation itself, the crown comes, you place it, what happens? your crown will come front more labially than the adjacent teeth. So what you will think? You tell technician you still reduce, send, place it and send it back. No, it's better you reduce your preparation, send it back and bring it. So how much ever he reduces, it will not go back. He may reduce maximum 1 mm, 2 mm. He can't reduce more than 2 mm because he'll send you the coping back. So it's always better to have enough preparation, especially in the maxillary anterior labial. So all ceramic. Same steps what you do in this, only difference what you have in a metal ceramic, in a all ceramic crown or a porcelain jacket crown. Tell me, what difference you have?
Biplane
reduction
on the labial surface.
Biplane or both? Biplane. No, labial reduction for anterior is biplanar. That will be any type of preparation you do, metal free, you do with metal ceramic. It is biplanar. Only difference here will what? The amount of reduction. The amount of reduction will be slightly more. You will be reducing more for a metal compared to PF. And you will have a what type of finish line, palatally and proximally? It's completely shoulder. Shoulder or radial shoulder. How will you do a radial shoulder? Anyone knows? You can do radial shoulder by using the round and tapered fissure bar and rounding of the internal line angles. What 90 degrees L you are getting, that L inside part should be rounded. Then it will form a radial shoulder. If you want to bevel the end of the margin, you can see all this, how to do it. Shoulder will be flat 90 degrees. Okay? This is shoulder which is beveled. The beveling margin you can use a chamfer cutting bar. See, now you can see, doctor was asking about the chamfer finish line. So chamfer will be obtuse angle. Then you can use heavy chamfer. You can use again the round and tapered fissure bar. Chamfer is the torpedo or the chamfer cutting bar which is used. So clear everyone, this is most important. The better you achieve the finish line, the better the longevity of your processes.
How do you maintain the shoulder in the proximal area? I have faced the difficulty when you are cutting in the proximal thing, your shoulder gets chipped out. So it's like, I'm not able to, you know, maintain.
Basically what happens is, that's what I told you. I told you, you have to leave lip of enamel. What was the advantage there is, you don't have underneath, you will not be able to achieve a finish line like how you can achieve it on the buckle or the lingual side. Because you have a solid tooth structure on the buckle and the lingual side. Here you don't have a tooth structure. So when you don't have a tooth structure, when you reduce proximally, you don't have underneath anything. It's an empty space. Interproximal because it is bulged. So you have to create a finish line using half the width of the shoulder finishing bone. What are you using? You can create. You're not.
Clinically, what happens if you have not created shoulder proximally, but you have created labial and buckle? So do we, is there any modifications for that or?
There is no modification. You have to try to create, at least if you cannot have the width what you have on the buckle and back, at least half the width you want. That is much better.
So you mean to say a little bit of lip of that enamel or the tooth structure to be left is better?
No, lip will be not left. No, once you remove it, the lip will fall down. It doesn't have any support. No?
How do you maintain the lip? I mean, you are showing, no? Some time back.
No, the lip was before the finish line.
Not, finish line is not the lip. Lip I told you to leave so that you don't damage the adjacent teeth. It is not with the finish line. It's not related to the finish line. It was related so that you don't damage the adjacent teeth with your burr. So I told you leave because interproximally you have enough thickness of enamel.
So do we continue the case in case if you have not achieved the shoulder one side and achieved all the three sides? So do we continue the case with the same impression or do we?
It's better you create a finish line and then.
So again redo the proximal.
Only the proximal and redo the impression. Because after you suppose you make the impression, then do the finish line, but that will not be incorporated in your restoration what you are getting from the lab. Because what you would have sent, impression will be without a finish line. So I'll just show you one video. You can see how they prepare for a metal field. You can ask me if you have any doubts. Full screen.
Double.
Same steps what I have told, you can observe it whether he is incorporating or not. So here what he is doing, first he is making grooves on the labial.
Half of the bird depth or?
Half. See why I tell you do it half is, if you do it full, again you will end up doing more. Because you will be finishing, you definitely reduce another 0.2, 0.3 mm after you remove the cell. See, once you master, you can always do preparation with your own will or your own skill. Just to develop the skill, I am telling you what all you have to follow. See, here he is directly doing the
gingival,
directly he is doing first step. He is not reduced incisor. He is first doing the labial, then he will do incisor. So once you have mastered the skill, you can use any bar and do the preparation also. That's what I want to tell you. If you master the skill, then it's till you master the skill, you should. See, now he's doing your incisor. So whoever is doing hands-on, it's like a demo for you. Showing a porcelain jacket crown or a metal figure, flat and tapered diamond. You have to create finish lines.
The ideal color of the bug, that is red or blue-green?
We use blue.
The shilling bug says red burrs for...
Red turquoise. See, basically every company has their own method for determining their sizes of birds. So if you take a Shofu kitting bar, he doesn't braid it blue, green or red. He gives his own kit. Or Echo you take, he gives money, he braids it blue. So everyone has their own. Green is the process. Green, red, then blue, and then yellow. Yellow is the smooth and the polished.
For this anterior, just you shown the preparation, the lingual or the palatal. how you analyze the symmetry of the depth palatally is the last what you showed. Sometimes it will be not equally, I mean, from the singular.
With the putty index you are talking?
That is one of the way to otherwise.
See, low maxillary ideas you can use your to evaluate. See, wax you can take, but labially it's very easy to evaluate yourself with your eyes.
Yeah.
If it is posterior teeth, it's very difficult on the lingual what is happening. That's why you try to use metal strips so that you see whether you have got attained the clearance. Anteriors, you will not have much of problem unless until you have a deep bite case. If it is quite deep bite, then you always try to give metal islands at that junction. Cases where you have deep bite, my advice is that area you leave a metal island. Otherwise, you will try to do which, labial reduction of your mandibular, trying to do enameloplasty, reducing the lower, then reducing the upper. So, you can directly instruct the lab to give a metal island, only that area to have a metal exposure. Always that is better. See, if you have a ceramic which is in intimate contact with your anteriors, what will happen? Your anteriors get attrited, nothing happens to the ceramic. Your anteriors on the longer run get attrited.
So canine preparation is same as
the inside, is it? Yes. It is same preparation, all anteriors same, that's why I showed you one page. Posteriors it is same. Only the amount of reduction what you do is different.
One thing what I felt is the canine default whichever you try. But to replicate the natural anatomy of the canine is the most difficult default whatever lab you say. So is there any specific reduction for the specific side of
the advantage of canine is, I told you the thickness, labio-lingual is weak. That's why you find problem in canine. In anteriors, what you will find problem? You will have underprepared always. You will get crowns which are over-contoured. You have not learned, always end up in that. But incisor what happens, you reduce optimum and get scared where your pulp get exposed. But your canine has thicker enamel surface than your. So you have to reduce the little more. See here, in theoretically we see 2 mm, but basically if you really evaluate it critically, you will be reducing more than. They say 2 mm, but you will actually reduce more in cases which are quite bulky, like can I know what you want to replicate, you might have to look back. So you have to prepare your canine slightly more than your incisors or laterals. That is the problem in the labio-lingual 20 thickness.
What is the minimum thickness for a metal frame?
Pardon?
Minimum thickness for a metal frame?
Minimum is 2 mm. See, if you take a metal ceramic, there is a 1.8 mm technically. If you take a metal free, it's 2 mm, 2.2 mm, you can.
Minimum.
If you do less than 2 mm, it's impossible for him to give a crown with good ceramic build. You will have again that metal tinge appearance or chalky appearance. Those problems you have. So after you do all this preparation is retraction. Anyone does retraction? I don't think anyone will do retraction. All are busy doing great. So Dr. Nadir is great doing it. So very few practitioners practice retraction. So anyone does? Everyone will retract only lip and cheek and tongue. No one does retraction of your ginger. So how to retract, what you use? So you have available called as retraction cords. Methods are mechanical, chemico-mechanical, surgical is there but we don't do it. Then the cordless. So just the basic steps which highlights you for your help in clinical practice. I'll not be going much in detail about it. So what is the disturbance for you there? Always the disturbance is your saliva, your blood, your cerebral fluid, all these are the disturbance for you. So to remove all this disturbance, there are saliva ejectors or the suction tips what we use, okay, or cotton you can use. This, what is this, anyone knows?
Cord packer.
Very good, name of the cord packer, that is important. Everyone know it's cord packer, what is the name of the cord packer? The other day someone had put a scissor and that round around the video put. You know why that round is around the scissor?
To keep that 10
family. No, for that you have different this. That round doesn't have any relation. All of you would have observed that scissor, it has a circle in the center. The lock is there different. That you will just to hold your ceramic crown. So you have that circle, you know why?
Because
You know why? So that when he is building up and keep aim, his ceramic should crown or the build-up should not touch the slab. That's why that circle is there, that circle keeps his crown like this. Because he is attaching his crown in the front with the scissor. He'll be building up, seeing, keeping, then taking the powder, then mixing it, again building. So that if he keeps it like this, your ceramic is touching the floor or the slab, whatever he is using there. Yes. That's why that has that round aim. Which prevents it from contacting the surface. So next, fissure. This is called as Fischer's cold packer. It will have just slight projections on the tip point, same like a condenser or your plastic filling instrument, okay? Wherein it will have ends, small slits so that you can push the thread.
It's like so, parallelogram condenser.
Yeah, yeah, something like a condenser. So this is a retraction cord. You get it in different sizes. So what size to use? What size to use? You have 000, 000, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2. So what size you use? 000 is thin or thick? It's the thinnest. So 00 is the most common what we use. As the size increases, the thickness increases. Okay. So again you have braided, unbraided, then impregnated, non-impregnated, all these things. So when you use a retraction cord, you start from your interproximal area. Push your cord towards your teeth. Don't push towards your sucker. Push it towards your teeth. Pass it to the interproximal limit. So always if you want to use any chemical, what you can use aluminum fluoride, ferric sulfate. Okay, why you use all that? They are hemostats. That's why you can dip this thread, leave it and then place it. After you place it, leave it for few minutes. Then you can remove it and make the impression. Now here you don't want to use cord. You don't want to spend so much of time. What you can do, you call it as a, what is this, anyone have used? This is a cordless technique. Yes, it's foam cord and it's called as magic foam. Okay, so this is nothing, you have to just take it, inject it around the margins of the gingiva. And it get as capri caps. These are like this, which comes in three sizes, for incisor, premolar and molars. Place it and press it. So that you have your magic cord or the foam going in the between the marginal gingiva in the sulcus and leave it for few minutes. So what happens, this magic cord swells. After that you remove this capri caps, wash it, then make the impression.
Averagely what amount of time you really keep the
form? 2 to 3 minutes. So impressions, anyone will do impressions, all we have to do impressions. You will do alginate or elastomeric, that is the question. So here we don't discuss about alginate impression, we will be speaking only about the elastomeric impressions. So impression basically to you want to do in one step or you want to do it in two steps. Okay. So single step impression, what you have to do is you have to inject both. So you use two materials in elastomeric. If you want to use a single impression, then you have to use a medium body or the monophase. That is a single impression. For that it's better to make a custom. On the diagnostic cast, you have to make a wax spacer of tooth thickness, then make the custom. Then make complete holes like how your stock tray is, then make the impression. So when you are using this technique, single step technique, what you are doing is, you are injecting light body around the margin, over the prepared tooth, then you are mixing putty. On the other hand, your assistant or your co-doctor, whoever is with you, can mix putty simultaneously, then place it over the tray and then simultaneously place it. Now what is the disadvantage of the technique, or it's an advantage technique? Advantage only is it's time you are saving, that's all. The disadvantage in these techniques is the putty, when you're using the force, you will not have a limit how much force you use. So suppose you use more force, there are chances your light body gets out to your sulcus with very little amount of light body on the tip margin. So monophase, I told you, polyether from 3M, it's one of the best material, medium body. Okay. I have experienced, it's really good, you can also use sometime. Wherein it's a single stage, you can inject and also load the tray and load. Same step like how I told you. It's a single phase, no need to do two materials, it's a single material. Then putty wash. How do you do putty wash? First you have to make a putty impression. Means you mix the base catalyst, load over the tray, make the impression. Before making impression, on the impression what you should have? You should have a polythene sheet or a plastic sheet. Why you are having plastic sheet, you know there?
For the
space for your light bulb. So once you place with the polish, with the sheet, you are creating space all over for your light bulb. After you remove it, once putty is set, remove the polythene sheet. Then inject light body all over, then replace it in the same position. So you will have completely like this. You will have complete light body all over your putty. This is the putty here. You mix, load it, okay, apply plastic sheet over it, then place it in the kitchen. You can use thin plastic sheets or even from the company they give you with the putty. You can use that. After it is set, remove the sheet, place the light body right over, inject right over, then place it in the same position.
What is it scaling to?
This is just making, see, one more option is, suppose you don't either use a sheet or you don't have a sheet, now how will you create space for the light bulb? You don't have a sheet, your putty is in direct contact with the tooth prepared, so you don't have space. So certain people use scalpel to scrape it right around that prepared tooth, or you can use burrs, you can create space, then use the light body over.
But for the prepared tooth or the all over?
Only prepared teeth. See, basically we have to record your prepared teeth with the light body. See, when you are doing a single stage technique also, you will not be injecting putty right now. You are injecting putty only in the prepared teeth. So recording prepared. So the other thing is recorded with the same.
But usually what happens is, if you add light body only around the tooth, in two stage technique, you get a step in the imprint step.
Step should not come.
Step should because already the putty is set. You get a two step. So I think preferably you add when you have a spacer, preferably we add.
Yeah, spacer I'm telling you full. He is asking about the use of the scalpel or the burrs. They do only for that particularly prepared teeth. That's all. They will not do scalpel all over all the teeth. So it's better to use a sheet, plastic sheet, and then plastic or polythene sheet. That is better because it will give adequate amount of space, and the pressure what you are giving also will be uniform on all over here. So other techniques, everyone have seen or not seen, we have a machine from 3M also which mixes elastomeric material. Okay, that's easy to use. You can save some material and time. He charges 80,000 and he'll give you 80,000 material. Machine with the material of 80,000. So now we are in an era where there are no impressions. So what I spoke about impression, you can remove it and you can start doing digital impressions. So anyone has done any digital impression in the clinic? No one has tried? So it's, so if you use digital impression, you need not do any impression. So digital advantages of digital impression is, you will scan it in a couple of minutes. The person from the company will scan it in 2 minutes, or even if you buy a scanner, you will be trained how to scan it. Once you scan it, the scanner itself will tell you if you are inadequately prepared. That will only select the shape and he will directly give you a crown in couple 1 or 2 days. If you want model, he will charge you 100 rupees more. If you don't want a model, he will directly give you the crown. Okay, occlusion, everything is scanned, so there is even shade is also matched with the scan.
Lab people only
will come. You have to priorly inform him a day prior. DVG lab have 3M scanners, they do. Some people have Iodine, there is Hydro. There are many companies with these kind of scanners. So you can use any of them. So no need of any impression. Even they can make CAD-CAM temporaries also by scanning. If you are doing a full mouth cases, try doing CAD-CAM full mouth temporaries for the patients. Temporization, why you do temporization? Everyone know to prevent it from sensitivity, to give aesthetics to the patient or the speech or whatever reason patient wants for temporaries. What are the methods? How will you do temporaries? Anyone do temporaries?
Putty index.
Yeah, putty index one option. Any other options?
Direct method, indirect method.
You have 2 methods, direct, indirect. There is direct, indirect also. So there are 3 basic methods, direct, indirect, direct, indirect. So direct method, what you are doing, you are directly doing it in the mouth. Direct method, indirectly. Indirect method, you are doing it in the lab. Direct, indirect, how you will do? Direct, everyone knows, directly you are doing in the mouth. Indirect, everyone knows, you are sending it to lab and doing it, or you yourself doing it outside of the model. Direct, indirect. Okay.
On the cast.
Then approximately, you would have fabricated a temporary. you will do clinical preparation, then you will adjust in the moment, that same temporary. That is direct indirect. You are able to understand what I am telling you. Your temporary is done with the help of a scalpel in the lab. You make the temporary, keep it ready. Do the preparation in the patient's mouth. Bring this temporary back. Try to adjust the preparation, see. Whatever is shortcomings, you can make a diagnostic course, make it over it and then give it to the patient. So you will be saving some amount of time for the lab procedure. So there is a material called as ProTemp. All would have used it. ProTemp. So putty index is made on the cast before tooth preparation. Don't do tooth preparation and make putty index. Please do putty index first before preparation. Then you can always load the material, place it in the mouth, leave it for 2 to 3 minutes. Maximum 3 to 4 minutes. It sets, remove it, finish it, give it back to the patient. So always use for temporary use non-eugenol cement is always a better option because eugenol reacts with methamethacrylate, right? And eugenol also damages. What happens if you fix it with zinc oxide eugenol crowns? Temporary crowns. What happens? Anyone?
Softens. Causes
aspirin effect on the margin. Whole margin after you remove becomes red or it bleeds. So your whole of your marginal gingiva is damaged because of the
future. What if the tooth which you are going to prepare is broken?
I didn't say
if the tooth which we are going to prepare is broken, then we have to build up the tooth and then take an index.
What teeth you're talking about, the cast or intraoral?
Intraoral.
Okay.
We are going to make a direct measure.
Okay.
So already if the tooth is broken or if there is a chip off, then we have to ideally build up the tooth and then make a putty index.
See, if your tooth is broken, suppose you are taking some cusp is broken and you are going for a preparation, that is what is your doubt. So usually you can, see, one option is you can build up and remove the putty index from the first, or you can make the putty index. Make the putty index. When you make the putty index there, you what crown you will be getting will again have the same broken.
But the problem comes in anteriors. If it is a class 4 fracture, if you don't build up with the composite and then do a index, then your temporary also will be
have the So it, that's what I'm telling. So it's better you build up and then make the putty index. That's the better. So cementation, everyone know what cements you use. Most of us use a glass ionomer. Very few people might use zinc phosphate or polycarboxylate. For metal free, you can always use the Relax or the resin cements, any other brand also. So how to cement? So what everyone does, mix, load, fill and press hard. So that you get a lot of excess and your crown is full. So always you have to load only the walls of your crown. Don't need to load or mix and load the whole crown. Only the walls. That's more than enough. The thickness is more than enough. I told you the thickness as Dr. Pavit, 20 to 25 microns is more than enough for. Why you are doing cementation? All that I will tell you in the failures. So here you have to just take an instrument, run it on the walls. After that, this all should be done. First you have to do all the, check everything. I am talking only about cementation. Don't cement and then try to see occlusal errors, your fit and your first is your fit, your interproximals, your margin and all that is checked. You, if you have touched the ceramic or if you have had a high point, you have reduced, what you will do, you will cement it like that only. You have to send it back to lab, glaze it and redo it. Or if you have a polishing kit, you can polish. If you are using metal, you can polish. Okay, whatever you are doing. Then once you seat it, you always give an optimum amount of pressure so that your crown is seated completely on the margins as it was when you were checking before cementation. So all the excess should be removed. Okay. Then if it is posterior teeth, what you will use? What you can use? Only probe you will use or any other thing? Cotton roll.
Floss.
Yeah, you can use floss, explorers to remove the excess and interproximal.
How to check the interdental contact?
Interdental contact, see, there are two options. One, you can clinically see with your mouth mirror with the fit uniform is there or not. You can use proximally, you can use retraction cords to check the fit. So you will have optimum some amount of resistance. Clinically, you should have broad contacts. never advise the labs to give you thin or point contacts interproximate. If you have put broad contacts, it never is a site for your interproximate decay. If you have crowns which have slight gap, what you'll do, adjust and put little GIC lesion, see further if problem comes. Please don't do that. Always it's better you send it to the lab, rebuild ceramic, get it and rebuild. Even margins also, 0.5mm, 1mm is short, 0.5mm. Cement GIC is there, we will see later when problem comes.
Massage the gum.
Massage the gum. There are some people telling you massage the gum, it will grow out. So, these things and all. So what are failures? So failures is, you are committing errors. What are failures? It is committing errors. Failures are what? You are committing errors or by mistake it is happening? So actually we are committing, but we can't tell that, so we always put it happens. Okay. So we always have to identify them and rectify them. So what are biological failures? Most common failure. Please.
How to in a bridge when it's cement, how to remove the cement from the pontic area?
Floss only. You have to run the floss below it. Either side, and you always have slight amount of space below the pontic.
Yes.
You can easily pull out the floss between the pontic and the cup.
In the pontic area.
Yeah, before only you have to place. Before cementation, you can place. If you want to remove anything which is below the pontic or in the junction of the connector, below, distal to the mesial to the pontic and distal to the retainer, you can place the floss, then cement, remove it and pull it out. So there's no problem. Don't get scared that stuff. Floss will get stuck and I'll not be able to remove. Try doing one or two cases, then you yourself will develop confidence and interest to follow all these principles and protocols. And retraction cord is not so expensive that you fear you use something, it may be expensive. It's very, you can use that common. So most common failures are caries. Why this is happening? It's our own error or even patient error. It can be either way. So more than 25% of failures is because of caries. Survey and studies say more than 25% of failures are because of caries. So where all this option happens? Means where all can you see caries? So where are failures? One is you will identify. You don't identify there is decay. You will feel it is arrested caries. No, if I do of the crown anyway, caries is little there, it will not grow. There is no bacterial growth. So always there is caries, please identify, restore. Don't leave any amount of caries when you prepare the teeth, leave it and then do a crown over it because patient doesn't have pain, is not complaining. Please identify this one. Okay, if you have rough abutment margins. So now all failures you have to correlate with what I have told. Say rough margin should be there or not there. There should not be rough margin. So suppose you are leaving rough margins, you are giving a site for your bacterial growth. Overhanging margins. There is marginal discrepancy, that is your marginal short, okay? All this, the subgingival finish line, okay? And also, you should be, after you finish the procedure, you should always educate your patient that how to maintain. Certain cases, what you see, you do a good bridge. After a few years, patient comes. So, suppose he is your patient and you remember him doing bridge. First, what you will see in his mouth, what bridge you have done, is there or not? Is it okay or not? It's a psychological tendency when you see. Then you see margins and oh, yeah, okay, what I have done is good, he doesn't. You'll feel yourself happy that I have done a good job to the patient and it's restored well and he's come back for some other problem. Suppose you see a bridge where your margins are short, but you feel your margins were fine, what would have happened?
Super eruption
happened when you have a bridge. Most of these patients do a wrong brushing technique. They have a habit of brushing horizontally. Especially on the crown, they try to brush still harder than what they brush because they don't feel any pain. No? Your natural teeth, you will feel that you are brushing on the crowns. So there are chances, so you should always educate the patient about the brushing technique, how to maintain. So in patients who are xerostomic, who are medically compromised, handicapped or a syndromic patients, will definitely have some other problem with these kind of issues.
Yeah,
Sir, sorry to interrupt. You told that rough, after tooth preparation there will be rough margins, sir.
There should be smooth margins.
Yeah, I mean, if the rough margins will be prone to caries. After our prone preparation, can we smoothen the margins with the yellow
pus? But before making impression, you have to finish all the procedures.
With the yellow?
Yellow pearl is used. Yellow pearl is used for polishing.
So that can be
used? Yeah, it has to be used. Not you, it can, it should be used. You have to polish. You have to smoothen your restoration, your finish line and your complete restoration. So pulpal degeneration, when this happens?
Close to the pulp.
Yeah, close to the pulp, or you are using an aerator without water. Water is not there in the clinic. Water is not there in your...
Old burrs.
More excess pressure. Your old burrs. Burr is not running, but you want to do it fast. You're putting pressure on the aerator. Last, you'll end up changing your cartridge of the aerator.
China.
So all this irritation is again same thing, and lack of provisionalization. So all these factors. Periodontal breakdown. Prime factor. Why this happens? Periodontal breakdown is again related to your biological wealth or your margin adaptation of your cow. Same things what I have told, you have to just correlate. Here again your fit of your margin. So most common site of problem is your junction of your crown with the restoration. Crown and restoration, that is the most prone site for problems because of your fit or because you have gone subgingival or it may be short. So that is a site where you have these problems.
I think excess cementation of is one of the...
That I will tell. You have a lot in failure, so I will discuss. So when this problem happens, you can tell anyone. When you can find this kind of point or this kind of problem?
Pressure?
Yeah.
By pontic seated on the gingiva?
Yeah, pontic definitely has to be seated on the gingiva. This is a cantilever pontic. If you carefully see, it's a cantilever pontic. So the forces, whatever is falling, is going there. So when this is a canine, the lateral, they have done a cantilever. So what has happened here, can you see? So these are the problems what you land up when you are doing a cantilever. Here also would have happened, even palatally also there are chances if you have given a wing or a rest. This you can see when this problem happens, overhanging margins. You have the overhanging margins. You have subgingival finish lines. Okay, how your crown should rest on the margin. Can you see this image? This is an open margin. You have a margin just short. This is again an overhanging margin. This is a perfect. So whatever you have, it should be seated on the... So this is the most prone site. Maximum failures happen because of this. Occlusal problems. All of you have occlusal problems. Patient comes, definitely you have to do some amount of occlusal errors. So rarely you find crowns without occlusal errors. So if there is very light, what you will do? You will remove the opposing. Because you don't like to touch the ceramic. You will try to do enamoplasty for the opposing. Right? Am I right? If you find all are doing opposing, you will slightly grind off. Patient, suppose patient is clever, he'll ask, why you are touching that seat? You will tell, no, that is sharp. Just grinding. So you always see to it that you reduce your ceramic. Please do not try to avoid touching your natural unless until it's a plunger cusp. You're in its an unavoidable condition. You try to do it. So always you have to send it back to the lab. So occlusal errors are very commonly seen. So if there are more occlusal errors, what will happen? You will cement send off. You have to evaluate. So there are more occlusal errors, chances what? Breakage of your ceramic is an option. So if you have periodontal, if you are doing crowns on a periodontally compromised teeth, patient will come back after few days with mobility. Periodontal breakdown and mobility. So initially if you identify the occlusal problem and rectify it, it doesn't go for a permanent damage. So temporarily whatever damage has come, it will come back.
TMD
issues. TMD issues if you are doing long span bridges. If you are doing short or one or two crowns, you will not have that problem of TMD immediately. Because if you have a very short span, then you will not have problem. If you have a longer span, that is 5 unit, 4 unit on one side, then you will have, because here there will be no contact, here there is high contact, the patient will be trying to bite more on this side. He will be trying to bring this equally, he himself. If you have not, and if you tell, no, it is perfect, use it for 2-3 days, it will come alright, you can use, and you send the patient out. So you shouldn't do this, evaluate it, use an articulating papers, check, recheck, then.
Sir, what is the, for minimal problems, occlusal problems, what you said just now, if it is a minimal occlusal problems, which does not require to be sent to lab, you are doing clinically in the clinic, what should be the proper way of doing it?
If you have marked it with the occlusal marks, wherever you are getting high points, that will be reduced. You can use silicon cups and you get a ceramic polishing kit. You can use that, polish it and give it back to the patient. It is very nice and you don't like it to send it and again call the patient next day. You can use that and do it. Even metal also you can polish it with a straight hand paste. You have metal polishing kit, you can use that silicon rubber disc and acrylic burrs at a slow speed and you can polish it. That's not a problem. Even if you can have a small lathe in your clinic also, you can keep it in a small lathe. You can use that for polishing your metal crowns or the ceramics.
If you are doing the upper and lower, one quadrant, is it advisable to do both together or finish one quadrant per hand and you know recall after 3 or 4 days and do the cutting for the upper? I am talking about unilateral site.
You can do either way, there is no problem. You can do both together or you can complete one and do the other. So the problem what you may think is, suppose you feel the amount of tooth what is available is not there, there is some amount of supra eruption, like how we saw one case earlier. Those cases it is better you do one section and do the other section. And the contralateral side is very important in these cases. The contralateral you should have a good stable occlusion. There also if it is a partial edentulous, half up, half down, then you might have to do section. If not, you can do, if you contralateral side, you have all the teeth with intimate contact, you can definitely go ahead with the simultaneously both. Not an issue.
Sir, when to record the occlusion? In what cases it is required to record the occlusion?
Occlusal bite?
Yeah, bite.
See, occlusal bite can be recorded using your wax or you can use even bite recorders. You also have material which will record occlusal bite. You can use alu wax. There are 2-3 metals what you can use to record your bite. When to record is a question. So when to record by is when you don't have a centric stop. Now what is a centric stop? Next question. You will not have a bite. Which teeth you are preparing has a centric bite? That's a different issue. What teeth without preparing that teeth you should have a centric stop. Then you don't need a wax bite. If you are doing a long span bridges, you should definitely do a bite and there is a posterior edentulous. When you have posterior edentulous on the contralateral side, definitely you need a bite. Even though you might have a bite on a premolar or a canine on the contralateral side, posterior though you will not have a patient, the technician will not be able to orient your models. So he will take a wax bite, articulate it, then do it. So you are able to understand, whenever you don't have a posterior centric stop, it is always a must to record your wax bite.
Any definite thickness of the model? We generally use modeling waxes.
Yeah.
Any definite thickness, we fold it one.
Yeah, you can fold it two, dip it in hot water and then take a bite, complete uniform bite all over so that you have a good bite. If not, you just repeat it. Don't try to adjust with the seat. It hardly takes a minute or a two to do it. Unless until if patient has an unstable bite, you may take some time to record it. If not, it's very easy or a simpler way to record it. Dip it in hot water, double thickness. Put it right round the arch and ask him to bite.
If you have lost posteriors bilaterally, you don't have proper stop. So, how are you getting a proper bite? Because those patients maybe have a lateral movements or sometimes slightly change in the same.
See, you are telling me a case with edentulousness posteriorly. Yes. But what you are preparing there, that you have to tell me so that I can give an example how you can restore it. You're able to understand what you're doing. You're telling posteriorly you don't have teeth, but what teeth you have prepared? If you give me an example, I can tell you. See, if you're doing a crown to a teeth where there is no teeth, you're doing only one crown in a canine, or somewhere one or two crowns, there are no posterior teeth, you might have to as well do a jaw relation to the patient, like how do you do in a complete denture. you have to establish is vertical in the lab and build up according to that. So if you don't have a posterior stop anywhere, you have to establish a new vertical. To establish new vertical, you have to follow the complete denture procedure how you follow for the establishment of the vertical.
How do we avoid the high points other than minimal, not correctly prepared to, there is high point in the lab sense. Other than that, there are any other reasons due to wrong impression techniques?
Yeah, definitely. If your impression is wrong, definitely if the lab technician is a trained technician, he'll definitely don't do even coping of it. He'll send it back to you, tell him, repeat the impression.
Because what happens is in the mouth, intraorally there is space, intradentally. And even in the class there is space. But when you place the crown or the coping while taking the trial, you feel a high point.
See, in those cases what would have happened is the way you would have made the impression would have been wrong. Or what everyone will do, make an alginate impression, throw it in the water, the tub or in a jug and leave it, let the technician come forward, take it and go. So these are the errors what most of the clinicians, small practices are doing. Make impression, they put it in water and leave it. When technician may come tomorrow, evening or next day he comes. He then pours the cast. Your impression should be accurate. That's why I tell you, always use elastomeric impressions when you are doing bridge cases. Single crown, okay, you can use arginate, no problem. But after you make an arginate impression, it's important to immediately pour it to avoid that synergesis and the imbibition properties of your arginate. Okay. So what problem? Who has done all these cases, these kind of cases? So what is this? This is a post. So you are putting it where? So till the post is within the circumference of your solid tooth structure, you are safe. Till it is here, not break the margin, till inside you go anywhere, it is very good retentive. Till you place it, it is the best post because it will never come out. If you go in the wrong direction and engage it, you all use that gold screw post and all this. Actually, that are not technically to be used. So they use screw, they put it where it is going, they try to push it with that device what is available. So always use fiber post if you want to use prefabricated. If you want to use fabricated, you can go use the NPG, that is the gold alloy, or you can use a cast material. These are advisable. So best technique or safe technique I can tell you, when you are preparing or removing, simple thing is you have to remove GP, leave, what is the concept in doing post preparation? You have to leave GP about 5 mm for your seal, apical seal, 5 mm. Remaining of GP you can remove. Simple, when you are removing GP, what you use to remove GP? You will use a piezo. So when you are using a piezo, it is simple. Remove, make piezo go where there is GP. Don't try to push piezo where there is no GP. Because your piezo has a cutting tip. The sides don't cut, only the tip cuts. So that's why you always have a view where your gutta percha is, try to go there. So people who have done root canals posteriorly will not do these kind of mistakes. People who have not done root canals, try to do post, will land up in these kind of problems because they will not know the axis or the angulation where your canals run. That is a drawback wherein patients who are not endodontists or who don't practice endodontics try to do post themselves. Till if you perforate in the crown portion, nothing, no problem. If you perforate only in the periodontal ligament area, you land up with the patients complaining of the bone loss. Can you see these kind of posts anywhere? It's done the crown also, patient has not come back. What has happened? Completely ill-fitting crown. So always select a tooth for a post which is at least 2 to 3 mm above your gingival margin. Don't select teeth who have been fractured below the gingival margin and try to do post and pour in a crown. That will not last more than a year or two. Patient will come back with the post and crown in that. Always your margin should rest on the solid tooth structure of the post. So this is a case report. Now whoever is a good practitioner can tell me what you do. This is a patient, okay. She has a bridge in this. It's already root canal treated. Okay, root canal completed 7, 5, 6, 7. She has a bridge, she's come back with a loose bridge. Complain of a loose bridge. What all could have happened after 12 years?
They might be undermining caries in 7, which has caused the fracture.
Undermining caries in 7. Okay, maybe. Any other guesses?
There is a fracture on the distal root.
Fracture on the?
Distal root.
Distal root, huh? Any other guesses?
Undermining caries on 4 also.
4 there is caries, sir. Okay.
Distal.
After 12 years, patient has come. Complaint is loose bridge.
Secondary abutment.
So what has happened here is on examination, the bridge is loose in the premolar area, not in the root canal rated tape. Bridge is loose in the premolar area, that means you can feel. How you will know which is loose? A patient, you will shake and see. But which is loose, you will not be able to understand. If your abutment is mobile, you will be confused what is loose. So how will you identify? So best way to identify is, don't air blow or anything. Just put slight finger pressure on your retainers. Wherever you see slight amount of saliva or some amount of bubble punching out, you can feel like how they check punches, you will be able to know that there is, that retainer is loose. So after that, you go for a radiographic assessment. You have seen that what has happened, your distal abutment is mobile. The root canal treated is, everyone thinking there is decay, there is fracture, but the problem is, this is mobile, but retainer is not mobile, tooth is mobile. So clinically examination, there is about 8 to 9 mm of pocket on the 7. So mobile, so what you do? How will you remove it now? You can even guess, how can you remove this? Now, what teeth is mobile? Your bridge is perfectly seated, your retainer is well cemented. Where it is loose is the premolar. Then strike with the crown remover.
Cut
it and remove the notch. Okay, what? How will you cut? You have, how will you cut? Where will you cut? You cut both? See, this is already loose, no? If you cut at the junction of the premolar, you are making the mobile segment separate from the what retainer has come out. Everyone understanding or shall I repeat?
Yeah.
You section it distal of the 5 so that you can use the same crown. What is mobile is 7 and the pontic of 6 you are extracting because it is grade 3 mobile. You extract. So here what you are doing to the 5, you can always do what you will do to the 5 root canal, post and core, you are post placed and then you will use the same crown. So what has happened, you see this pic, you will understand. Your 7 is mobile. So what is mobile is going up, right? Whenever she is using it or whenever she is biting, it is moving. So where are the stresses falling? Stresses is falling on the premolar. So once these stresses are falling, what has happened? Your 5 retainer has become loose. So it has become a site for plague, debris, foot deposition, decay of denting and ultimately fracture. So this kind of cases are very common. Clear everyone how this has happened? This is the case report that I showed you. See, they have restored it with root canal. So now what next treatment? Now patient doesn't want implants. You have done a post and core. What other options you have for fixed? Anyone can tell?
Precision and transmission.
Yes, very good. So you can use precision. How do you use precision? Pardon? No, what all you do to what all you prepare for a precision attack?
Crown threads, 2 premolars.
Okay.
Then you give crowns with the
middle part.
You can see this image to understand. You can use 2 premolars for 2 molars. Your 2 premolars should have good abutment, periodontal, healthy teeth. Don't take mobile teeth and try to do all this because your lab expenditure will be 6,000 to 7,000 to do this. Okay. And some labs up to 9,000 also. So don't take risk in doing some mobile tape to experiment these kind of things. Always you should have a good crown root ratio in the periodontal. So here it is simple. You get this, you can try this, you have this cap. You know what is this? This is the one. This has to be removed by the patient once in a day or couple of days. Clean it and again place it. So this comes for how many days, you know, service, how many days you have to change it?
Depends on the lab. As they ask us to change the rubber, right?
Yeah, you have to change this rubber after every 4 weeks. Okay, next is the, I'm talking about the Ferro's mechanical.
Sir, you are telling about the rubber to be changed.
Precision attachment.
Precision attachment, I told whole thing, not told. Huh?
Yeah.
So you prepare two premolars, metal ceramic crown with a precision attachment on to this. So rubber caps can be changed in a year to 2 weeks. It's not changed every week or 4 weeks. It comes more than a year, up to 2 years, depending upon how your patient is using it also, the way he is putting it and removing it. So minimum of a year to 2 weeks. So mechanical failures. So what are mechanical failures? Basically what you are using for looting is your cement. So what your cement is doing? Your cement acts as a seal between the marginal decay and also prevent your pulpal irritation. Both. Your seal is, it's a seal between your crown and the restoration. Teeth and the restoration. So where failures you see is basically mechanical is because of your fit, inadequate fit, or you have a short margin, your retainers or your crowns, wherever you are not evaluated it before cementation. So these kind of cases where you have short margin, overextended margin, you have to evaluate. Otherwise, so basically there are one crowns with, who don't do die spacer technician. Suppose he gives you a crown without a die spacer, and or your crown is very tight. You're not able to place it, you try to somehow push it and place it. And the space in inner surface may be more, but that is not visible to you. Because what inside the crown, anyone can see? No one can see. We just have an approximation, taking a crown, placing it over it and evaluating. We don't know how much of space is there between your crown and the restoration. How will you know how much space is there? How can you know?
Even the cement.
No, flows out, no, but before cementation, how will you know how much space you have?
On the cast.
On the cast also, how can you see? Can anyone see? No one can see. No, it's inside the cast. How will you know how much of this?
If he has applied the die spacer on
the... No, he would have applied die spacer, but you will not know how much of space is there, no, between your crown and this. Now we say optimum, like Dr. Purvis is telling, 20 to 25 microns of looting. But we don't know, no, how much of space is there. Can you know or you know after cementation? You can't know. Only after you remove the crown you can know.
Yeah, cement.
Cement. What? You can use some material like light body. Okay? Place it. If you are doubtful now, I'm not talking for every restoration you have to do. If you have any doubt about the fat or you're confused with the space available in there, you can always use a light point set within 30 seconds to 1 remove it and check. So inner surface how much you have, you can, even you want, you can measure it also with your caliper to know. So if you have a feather layer margins, then you can tell it's fine. You can use, if you have a doubt, if it is very tight or you have some amount of discrepancy, some amount of rocking. See, long span bridges, you will definitely come across restorations which are slightly moving also and rocking also. So those cases you have to recheck with all those things before you cement. So when you have tight restoration, your cement is getting locked. It will not be able to flow out if you have tight restoration. So thickness is also plays an important role in the restoration. See, if you have more thick cement in between your crown and the crown and the restoration. Okay, so one option is, when this happens is one you will see, try to cement it after your looting cement is almost close to setting. You are in hurry, trying to do it in a urgent or a shabby way. You try to put it and somehow you'll ask him to buy it, it will go into occlusion. You try to do that kind of job, you will end up with this kind of thing. You will have more cement in between, your vertical would have increased. Okay. After that also you are ignorant and you leave the patient. What happens to this cement after some time? This is dissolved with your saliva. After some time, you lose whatever cement you have outside, even if you don't remove it, you lose this part of cement after some time. And this becomes again a site of what? Margin leakage, again the site of decay, or patient comes back with sensitivity, hypersensitivity, then goes for root canal and then again redo the whole procedures. What are the reasons you lose retention? Basic reasons of retention. Patient will be coming back to you always in those crowns. After every month or 15 days or 2 months, you always have to evaluate your own preparation workload. If your preparation is short, not up to the mark, no finish line, if your crown fit, all this should be evaluated. If crowns are short, repeatedly they'll come. If your crowns are over tapered, they will come. So how to examine bridge? I told you that I know you have to use your fingers, press and see where your retainer. You see some amount of saliva coming out so that you will know air bubbles coming out to detect that which retainer is mobile or loose. Okay, once one retainer is loose, like how I showed you the case report, it is disastrous. So definitely you will end up fracture of your crown bone. So always the plate formation is always in space between the retainer and also the abutment. Caries in these cases develop very fast. Caries on enamel moves slowly, but caries in dentin moves fast. So what are the solutions you have to see? So you always have to identify the problem, what is wrong there in your mechanical failures, what is wrong. Always wrong is most of the mistakes in the failure is from the dentist himself, not from the patient. Whatever errors or failures we are seeing, it is because of us. So identify, re-cement it. If your preparation is not up to the mark, you have to re-prepare and redo the crowns. Don't try to adjust with the same crowns. Okay. If there is no mistake, yeah, only the crown comes out, you can remove the cement, sandblast the inner surface of the crown and re-cement. So you have seen any case of this? Patient has come back to you telling his crown has been swallowed. So what will you do? What is the solution for this? Patient comes back to you telling a bridge is swollen. I have seen a case, patient swallowing crown, patient swallowing a file, patient swallowing a bridge. So what will you do in these cases?
Refer to gastroenterologist.
Take a chest x-ray, see whether the...
Yeah, you have to take an abdominal x-ray, or the patient to get an abdominal x-ray. First you evaluate, you have to see whether the patient is honest or not. So first you evaluate whether it is there in his abdomen. If it is there, you can always wait for 24 hours to 36 hours for it itself to come out. So God has made nature such that you swallow crowns or bridges, they definitely come out, they don't get stayed anywhere. So as you say, if it gets stuck, it's an RPD which has a class, which got stuck somewhere. Maybe that time someone had put videos on WhatsApp that they did a surgery to remove an RPD out and all. So basically dentures, it is very difficult to see in the scan. It will not come in an X-ray. So you might have to do an endoscopy to evaluate if it is acrylic. If it is a metal ceramic, definitely you will be able to visualize it. You can put patient on what? If patient has swallowed it, really. Yeah, you can put him on laxative, ask him to wait for one day, recheck, and then come back. Okay, tooth fracture. If there is slight amount of fractures, always you can restore it with the fillings, okay, or the cement or amalgam or composites. If there are large coronal fractures, you can restore it with the crown. If the fractures are more involving your pulp, you have to do endodontic. If you have more walls damage of the restoration, then you have to do a post and core and then do the crown. So what are the causes for coronal fracture? What you see? Fracture, excessive tooth preparation, especially fractures you see most common in maxillary anteriors and premolars. You rarely find fractures in molars because of your bulk of the teeth. You find more in incisors because teeth is small, you would have prepared more. So you fracture it, patient is something hardly fracture it, or you yourself fracturing while removing it. There are chances while removing, you try to hit it with a spring-loaded bridge, your crown and the teeth come. What you will do? What you will tell the patient? Patient will come to replace crown, you will end up sending him for root canal, post and core or extraction. So how to avoid that, I will tell you later. So root fractures also common, post and core or vertical trauma, all these, there are many factors for why there are root fractures, there are crown fractures. So you have to evaluate, try to follow the principles what I have advised you, so that there is no fracture of your coronal or the root. Retainer, this everyone would have seen in your clinical practice. Patient comes back with metal crowns with perforations. Why this has happened? It can be happened on usage also. If it is not usage, most common it is because of you only. Yes, you have underprepared. Or you yourself have underprepared, you have a metal crown, you try to reduce as much as possible. Even if it's small hole is there, you send the patient off. Patient comes back after a few months to a year telling some food is going in between my crowns, and then you try to remove it and redo the crown. So try to please avoid those kind of errors so that you are honest with your work, what you are doing, and your practice also. So all insufficient reduction or high points, all these factors can be because of your retainer failures. Marginal discrepancy, I have already discussed many times, your margin is short or you have space between your adaptation of the crown to the margin. Okay, short margins, overextended, underextended. All this lead to failures. Facing failure. Anyone does acrylic facing crowns still? No one practices acrylic facing. Ceramic facing? Everyone does ceramic facing. Try avoiding that, try avoiding that also. You can always give a metal island. How much you are saving? 50 rupees? 100 rupees? Nothing more than that. Maybe you lose by getting 500 because you tell 500 less to the patient. Is a facing. So try avoiding using facings. Try to give full metal ceramic or full veneers, but you can give metal exposure or metal island exposures in the area where you feel you are not able to adequately reduce for the ceramic crystal. So these kind of failures, how will you manage? So one more is fracture. No, you can replace, depends on the fracture, you can always repair that. I will be telling you. So facing failures, everyone, why it will happen? It can be because of trauma, it can be because of what? Malocclusion, cross pipe, okay? Or not well done by your technician. We will just break for prayer, then I will continue with another, I think I have about 10 to 15 slides before we close up for lunch.
Is everybody hungry?
Acrylic veneers, so you will not find any discoloration. Will you find any discoloration in ceramic veneers? Will there be any discoloration in ceramic veneers? You don't find any discoloration in ceramic. It's only acrylic which has discoloration. So pontic failures. Will pontic fail? Pontics fail or don't fail? Pontics usually don't fail because you have enough amount of metal and ceramic on usually on the pontics than on the retainers. So pontic failure is only sign you are seeing in maxillary anterior when your design is wrong. When your design of the pontic is wrong, how will your upper maxillary anteriors look? Have you observed any patient comes to you, when he smiles, you will see some amount of dark space interproximal between your retainer and the pontic. That is because of your improper pontic design. you would, the design would have left some more amount of space in the embrasure. If that space is not closed adequately, you will see that triangular dark spaces in your maxillary anterior teeth. So you have to avoid that color. So secondly, the pontic designs, you have different kinds of pontics what we use. One is ridge lap. Everyone know what a ridge lap is? You have intimate contact with the pontic onto the buccal surface of the ridge. If it is a sanitary pontic, you use it in your mandibular molars where there is no contact. Your pontic is about 2 to 3 mm above your gingival margin, so that it acts as a sluice way, or your, so that there is no any foot getting stuck in between the pontic and your ridge. So connector failure, this is commonly seen. Connector failures are because of your thickness of the metal, one. Then other option will be, like the, in the lab when they are casting, there is some amount of impurity or some amount of air bubbles incorporation which makes the metal weak. And in patients who have heavy occlusal forces, if the connector thickness is not adequate, you always find the fracture of this connector. Occlusal wear. Occlusal wear is common in patients who have bruxism or heavy. So if a bruxism patient is there, what type of crowns you give? Or what do you indicate? Yes, it's always better to give metal crowns. Can you give gold or NPG crowns?
Gold.
Yes, you can always give an NPG also. Or metal. Please avoid giving which crowns?
Ceramic.
Why? Why ceramic wears or why ceramic fractures? Ceramic will not wear, your opposing teeth wears. Why ceramic fractures? What property of ceramic makes it so easily fractured? Because of its compressive strength being less compared to the metal. So always ceramic chips off or fractures in cases of patient with heavy occlusal process, heavy occlusal forces or bruxes.
What about monolith?
Monolith you can give. Monolith is all usually indicated in cases where you have short clinical crowns. If you have a short clinical crown, you give a monolith. It's anesthetic, usually given for your posterior teeth. So aesthetics, can anyone do aesthetics? None of us can match to the nature. We try to mimic or try to come closer to it, but we cannot make what God has created. So there is a saying, very few men have the ability to carve veneers to be perfect replicas of natural teeth, especially when you are handicapped by the limitation imposed by the metal castings and the necessity of providing enough bulk to obtain the color values or the translucence. So, comparison of best looking veneers, especially in multiple teeth, forces us to realize that perfect imitation of natural teeth is an impossible assignment. So how will you treat a case of this? You have a patient. How will you treat? You can use composites. You can do two crowns. You can go for orthotic treatment. What all you can go for?
First option is orthotic.
First option is orthotic.
Second option is veneers before in four teeth.
Four teeth veneers, okay.
One.
See, if you are doing veneers, Dr. Nadim, you need to have minimum diastema. If you have huge diastema, even if you do four veneers, you will actually not be masking the space what is left in the diastema. If the space what is available is more, it's always crowns are better to mask than using a composite or a veneer. Okay, one option. You can always have an orthodontic option one. Second option you can have crowns. So two crowns will be enough for him. You need four or you need six. You need eight. Six is ideal.
What if the patient is not ready for six?
So if you have very little space, first option will be composites. If the patient is
going against or not drilling for it. Ortho ante, first option is going for composites, then going for laminates. If the space is more, you might. So in these cases, you always keep it in mind, the mesial of this should be prepared less. Keep that in mind. Wherever there is more space, that side you prepare less, not the labial, only the proximal area. You try to prepare less so that what metal and what ceramic you will have of adequate thickness. Suppose you prepare more here, your technician will be forced to put in more of metal, more of ceramic to cover up that space. So these kind of areas are most commonly seen, where we see some amount of metal exposure or cervical exposure of marginal gingiva. You have, again, these are all the points where you have foci for plague, then foot debris, then decay. So always try to, anteriors you are doing, try to give a subgingival finish line with what? What type of finish line? Shoulder. You should always give a shoulder finish line, subgingival, and your finish line resting on the, where your finish line should rest? On the tooth structure, that is very important. Okay, if you have less thing, all these things you can think, opaque, you can see surface blistering or chalky appearance. Shade matching, how will you do shade matching, all of you? Wherever you sit, you will do shade matching, or there is something, how you match shade?
Natural
light. Where in the sunlight? You match it in the sunlight?
Outside
the clinic?
It's not possible.
It's not possible to take patient outside the clinic.
What if the patient will come evening? I have asked him come next day.
So basically you have to select shade in a natural light, not at the source of a sun. You can select it inside also. It's not a rule that you have to go in sunlight and select. If you select it in sunlight, you'll end up selecting a wrong shade. Your source, the patient should be towards the shade, towards the light or against the light. Or you should be towards the light. That's very important. Now you see, this is a door, everyone can see through. Now patient will be facing us or inside, or he'll be facing outside when you're selecting the shade. Patient should face outside.
Inside.
Patient should face inside. We should face outside when you select the shade. So that you don't have any light on the tree structure which mismatches you in shade selection. So whenever you're selecting shade, you feel what shade you have selected is perfect. You always feel what I've selected, A2, A2. The technician you will compare, he also has done A2. But when you place it in the mouth, there will be some amount of discrepancy. Why that happens, or how you can rectify it? Why that happens? Ceramic also comes in different brands, everyone know? Vita, Docera, Docera Gold. So you have different brands having slight discrepancy in their own shades also. So you have to have to know what type of ceramic is also building for you. So everyone has a different ceramic what they use in building crowns. So sometimes this also affects your tube preparation. I told you, you have to follow, have the adequate thickness for ceramic. If you don't have that, any shade you select, it will never match with your translucency and with the adjacent teeth. So always try to select the shade closest to your adjacent teeth while selecting. So these are very common, all of you would have seen. So there is complete what breakdown? Periodontal breakdown, okay, your connector exposure. I told you, triangular spaces. This is what you see in some kind of patients who already has a bridge, what you have done. Try to avoid having this. If you have this, whenever the patient size, you will see that dark spaces, dark triangular spaces, most commonly done because of your what wrong is there?
Pontic
design. Your pontic design goes wrong, you will go wrong there. Okay. So improper contouring, all this I have told you, your enough preparations, your contours, your colors, your angulation all should match with your contralateral teeth. You are doing on the left side, it should be similar what is on the right side. It may be posteriors or anteriors. You try to mimic the same anatomy, the size of the contralateral teeth. So repairs, how will you repair? So always you have stumbling blocks, how will you use them? So you use them to only difference is how you use it. You have to use it for climbing or stepping. So you will come across so many problems. So how will you rectify so many problems, seeing so many failures? What you will do? You will try to adjust using a restorative cement in those margins, sending the patient back, using composites. Anything you will do? You are not supposed to do anything. So you have so many problems. One is you leave it alone, you try adjusting or repairing, or you try replacing. So what is the damage? How much of damage has happened? Again, that goes. So you never try to mask the margin. See, repair is such that it can be done in a smaller increment or a smaller area. It should be not like extending a margin. If margin is short, your margin is poor, ill-fitting, don't try to repair those things. It's impossible to repair your margins which are short in your metal or the ceramic. So always don't try to repair. Yeah, repair you can do is only these kind of things wherein you have done good crowns which are aesthetics, wherein your patients come back with slight, is eaten something hard or slight trauma, somewhere where inside the ledge is broken, or you have some small breakage at this end or this end. Those cases you can repair. So don't try to repair the whole facing is broken and you have margins which are short. Don't try to repair all those areas. Anyone knows how to repair? Ceramic repair. Very vital, very interesting. So you have two companies which give you a repair kit for ceramic. One is Oco, one is Angelus. Angelus is slightly expensive. Oco is about 2,800 to 3,000, and Angelus is about 6,000. So how to use this is important. What acid, HN, what they are using is sulfhydrofluoric acid. Okay, it should be applied at this juncture. Then you have to again clean it or wash it after few minutes. Then you apply a silane coupling. Okay, that is for bonding of ceramic. Over that you get, from the kit you get an opaquer and a base and a catalyst which can be applied over the metal surface which masks the metal. See, if you directly do composite over it, what will happen? You will definitely have that metal translucency through it. Even though you use a micro hybrid or nano hybrid or any type of composites, you will be definitely having a, some amount of metal translucency there. So you always use an opaquer, then cure that, again bond over it, then you have to use your composite. So how to remove crowns? Everyone know how to remove crowns. What is the name of this crown remover? Anyone has this any crown remover in your clinic? Everyone has. That's the best crown remover according to me. Because why you know that is the best? Because you know the amount of force you are applying. If you are using, it is called as slidematic hammer type. Okay, this is a spring loaded. Here we don't have control over it. So first, while removing, what you do is you have to engage it first. The tip of this should be engaged. There are 2-3 varieties of tips. You can use any thin, there are thin, there are broader tips depending on the catch what you are getting. Catch means you are able to understand. You have to see to it that your crown remover is sitting properly in the margin. Don't keep it in the air and be striking and thinking it is not coming. Unless until you engage the retainer. Okay? So when you have bridges, you always try to strike in between the retainer and the pontic. Don't try alone in the pontic or don't try alone in the retainer. If it is a single crown, don't try to apply force in the center of the retainer. Take it the other end, mesial end or the distal end. So always use the palatal or the lingual side first option. If you are not able to get catch, then you can try. So how many times will you try this? Will be trying this only? You can strike once, twice, thrice with the catch. Without catch, even if you strike 10 times, it is of no purpose. With the catch, you strike. So when you are using spring loaded, you get a solid sound. When you strike, you get a solid sound which even you will get a bit pissed off. Okay, what sound is it? Solid. No? You feel that it is very hard, like a sound. So you always see for 1, 2 or maximum 3 strikes. If your retainer is moving, maximum 3, 1 or 2. you see if retainer is slightly moving. If it is moving and it is trying to come out, then you go on with the story. If it is not, please stop there. Then go for other procedures of crowning. So you have different type, even there is available called as, this is a different type, just you can use a ligature wire, tied it tight above, right round your retainer. Single crowns it can be done. And you can strike it on this retainer, or you can pull it hard and then strike. This is an optional for crown reward. Basically all of them, I don't think now it is available in market or not. If you have this, it is good enough. If not, this. But in this, only disadvantage is the amount of force you will definitely not know. Please don't try crown remover on teeth which are very thin and arcicated. Try avoiding on premolars and laterals which are root canal related. If you try experimenting, you will come with post the core and the crown will be together, except the root will be in the middle. So try avoiding that.
But why do you recommend only on lateral and premolar?
Not recommend. Don't use it. Because those teeth are very thin after it has been prepared, and any strike on that, you will land up losing the core also with the crown.
But I still feel this is very barbaric actually.
Yes. So always I am telling you, so it's better to use a hammer type is the best option, or you can use pneumatic. Pneumatic also comes, this gives, it's like jerks. You would have seen people using on the roads. It just jerks, it gives air pressure like that. With jets, so any crowns usually come out with this pneumatic. If it is not coming out, then again the problem is. One more is VAMK. Anyone uses this? No one uses this. It comes in three different sizes. You can just make a hole in your crown, put it in and just elevate or rotate it, just like how you remove teeth with wisdom teeth or some other teeth with elevation. Just try to rotate your crown. So you can use it in single crowns. Also more commonly used.
What is the cost of this pneumatic?
Pneumatic, I'm not sure. It's few thousands that much actually, but exact price I'm not sure. So if it doesn't come out, what will you do? Section. How will you do sectioning? You'll do sectioning wherever you want, or you have some particular way to section and particular burrs to use. That's very important. Carbide burring. On ceramic or on the metal, you'll use a carbide burring. That is important. Carbide burr, you use it on the metal. Okay. Ceramic, you can easily remove it with your diamond normal belt of this. So when you use this, it's better. So you have to section it. Buccal or labial, till the lingual also. Make it into build up could have been better. His safe selection should have been better. His margins are short. His margins are overextended. So always when you see other people's work, you always are critical in analysis. So it's always better to be more critical in analyzing our own work than analyzing others' work and commenting on it. So your failures define all of us or don't define us? So all our failures define us or not us? That's very important. So our failures define us, do not define us.
How do you rectify this moment?
Yes. So what, see, all have done errors, all will do errors. Learning from errors, not repeating the errors, not repeating those mistakes is more important. So all of you try your best not to do errors so that you can always have to build up your own business. So any doubts or anyone having any problem with your personal cases, you can tell me. Hope I didn't disturb everyone Sunday. I hope you learned something out of it.
I have a question about the crowns. Nowadays, most of the labs, they are coming up with so many crowns. Super translucent, so many things are there. So I would like to know what exactly is this. It is more of a marketing gimmick, or should we, how we can classify, or how we can go ahead and select according to cases.
See, basically, what you are talking about, super lucent zirconia has been introduced by the dent care lab. Yes. Those people are marketing about that. See, basically lab people, whenever they go for their like expo, what we have, they also have the material expo. So whenever they go out of the country for the expos, they always have a marketing team there which introduces new products. See, zirconia also, you have lot of zirconia. European lab people tell China zirconia, some person tell Germany zirconia. We don't know it is zirconia from Germany or China. Whatever he tells, we are taking it that in a positive way. So basically zirconia also, you have many crates and many varieties what they use. So it's your own personal perception what you want to use, and you can use. Zirconia is a good brand, but I usually prefer sending to a good lab when you are doing a metal free. I have used superlucent zirconia. It really has very good aesthetic values when you are doing it for anti-air.
What I understand is from the lab what they told, the coping what they give, the coping degree of opacity varies from the company to company. So the high translucent, super translucent, that gives you more of an Emax kind of a translucent finish. That is what they claim. And the strength, the flexural strength is very high.
1500 megapascals is the flexural strength of zirconia. So it has good enough.
So what should be an ideal flexural strength for a ground? Can an Emax be given for a posterior?
Usually we don't give Emax for posterior, it's only for the anterior movie, wherein you don't have much of deflective contacts or deep bites.
But they claim for a single unit crown they can be given.
Yeah, anterior.
The posterior they claim.
But usually we don't allow it because of the fracture. Fracture resistance is less than Emax. Disilicate it has. So we usually use zirconia only for the posterior. Even zirconia fractures, there are crowns and bridges wherein even zirconia fractures, I don't say no. But again, it depends on what quality is used. See, we don't know. We are all blind on what they are using. Whatever they are telling, we are taking it. So basically, we are telling.
Dr. Medha also to come forward and do the panel discussion. She is a postgraduate in post-orthodontics under Dr. Dilag. Please welcome Dr. Medha. Please come.
So you said about post-operative sensitivity. You said we should use less irritant cement, which is the lesser irritant cement.
We use resin cements. Resin cements are lesser irritant when you compare to the zinc polycarboxylate and glass cements. So that are better options. So always you, when you are using resin cement, you can use bonding agent.
Sir, if you have a patient who do not have any sort of financial reasons, means you have a patient doing up a posterior, which material would you select? Either a PFM or a zirconia, which one usually you select if you don't have any special reason, financial or anything?
See, financial is a burden to the patient or not a burden?
Not a burden.
Not a burden. See, always you go for a metal free zirconia. If patient is not burden and if he asks you do the best, you go for a metal free zirconia single crown. That is best. If patient is burden, then you can have another option. You can use lower grade zirconia like Aman Girgat, which will cost a little less.
Zirconia would require more preparation, but it's not a conservative preparation. So, where aesthetics is not a concern, you can as well go for a PFM or a DMLS. Rather go for a zirconia.
Perfect.
I'm just telling you for the
debate. Yeah, 100% true.
100% true. Only for the debate purpose.
Yeah.
So I would like to know about DMLS.
Conservative preparation is
laser centered. Pardon, 1 minute, I'll finish with you.
Yeah, yes,
conservative preparation is better in terms of saving the natural tooth, where aesthetics is not a concern, and where we need aesthetics, yes, definitely we can go for zirconia. So, what's your take on that?
See, if you go with the principles of tooth preparation, then if it is a posterior teeth, you have to do a full metal cut.
Full metal.
With ceramic as occlusal surface, remaining you can do metal. So, conservative if you want to. You want to think on patient demands or on the patient's preference, you can give him a choice if you want some metal free or a PFM. So PFM is well good enough for the posterior. If patient is very specific of metal free, you have to do metal free. There is no option.
There is one more thing about metal or PFM crowns. It's causing the, it's about MRI. Do zirconia crowns doesn't have any MRI?
See, I will tell you one thing. I have my own student, now she is colleague also. She had to go for an MRI. She had an implant with a PFM crown. So she called me from the scan center telling, Sir, they have asked me to do my scan, MRI. I have seen a pain in my ear. She had some gallbladder stones. So she had to go for an MRI. So she called me and told I have to go. Sir, they are telling me to remove the crown. Now to remove implant crown is really painful. It is cemented 4 years back. So I told her, you pray to God and go ahead with the scan. So she went ahead with the scan and after that she called me, nothing happened. So basically, everyone are feared that if you have a metal crown and if you have a PFM crown or if you have zirconia, there are chances that the MRI pulls because of the magnetic force, your crown comes out. I told her simple, see if it comes out where it will go, it will be in your mouth. Keep your mouth tight, come back, we'll reseam it. But actually there are studies telling that nickel chrome is not so attractive to the MRI scans. So now I have seen many people whom I have also seen that they have done. I have heard one person telling me that, I have not seen but heard telling that he had an implant which was pulled inside the sinus after the MRI. But I don't know how true it is. But seeing to the studies, it is said that the nickel chrome doesn't have any attractive towards the MRI.
What about the titanium implants?
See, that is what I am telling. Titanium I have heard, but as per the MRI latest, there are research saying that MRI doesn't attract both the nickel chrome and also the implants. So there is no problem with that, you can go ahead with that. If patients are very possessive, you can tell them what I told her. Keep your mouth closed.
These metal crowns will cause the distraction of the images of MRI. So if it is a skull MRI, then it will cause distraction of the...
Those times you might have to remove it and send it to the patient. This was, I told you, that it was an abdominal scan for her. So I told her nothing
to worry. Some of the patients actually complained to me saying that you did not inform us before placing the BFM. So we would have gone for a zirconia.
You should have told them, I didn't know you will go for MRI.
So I informed them that when I am giving an option of the crowns, I informed them that it might have to be removed in case if you are going for MRI.
It's better, see, if patient is so possessive, we can remove and send them, that's the only option. We had some patient, I think we had to remove braces also. And we have to rebond the whole thing again. So if patients are very possessive and fussy, we have to do it. But by seeing many patients and by the articles, it says there is no problem, you can go ahead with the MRIs.
I have a question to Dr. Mehta. When you are taking impressions with the silicone based material, then you apply the adhesive to the tray. After the impression sets, the model is taken, how do you take out that impression from the tray? It becomes so difficult to, you know, chip it out with your normal cover or something. So is there any alternate method to take it out?
You shouldn't leave the impression for a very long time, like you are trying to remove it after 15 days. That shouldn't happen. Once it comes back from the lab,
Applying adhesive to your tray before making the prior impression. Yeah. So that's why that's the problem.
So is that tray discarded or?
No, see, it's not discarded. It can be reused, but this problem you're facing because of your adhesive.
So you
try to use less adhesive.
Yes, sir, you perforated trays, there's enough of retention.
No need of using adhesive also, actually. If you have good perforation, especially plastic trays, plastic trays have more bigger vent holes when you compare to the metal trays. So if you use that, that's enough. Why avoiding using adhesive? Then I don't think
that. You suggest that since A-silicon is the gold standard for impressions, the C-silicon can be used as an alternative for the PFM or the impression. The disadvantage I heard is the amount of linkage which happens with the C is much higher than the A. Or A is totally zero. So how often as a doctor on the do you recommend C-silicons?
Availability and the fact that if you are planning to send the
lab
for a lot of time to
core,
then there is a chance that you might use condition silicon.
You mean to say use it as a study
model? No, condition silicon, because planning to send it to a lab which probably takes 3 working days to reach the lab, you're not coring it then.
Okay.
That is.
So coring your cask,
condition silicon, you have to core it after half an hour.
Additional.
Okay, it releases the gas.
Okay, so immediate pouring, you will see silicon.
Yeah, immediate pouring.
How much time gap for silicon?
24 or even 24 hours, no problem. Minimum 1 hour you should not.
Until 1 hour they tell you.
No, you should not pour in 1 hour.
Not pour.
24 hours? No discount. See silicon.
Adhesive, sir, you primarily use when you're using a special gel, using a monofacial pressure on that. You're not making vent holes. That's the reason why we're using the adhesive.
Okay. So you don't generally use it in the...
No, we use those alginate paste primarily in clinics, right? You don't
know. Any questions from any more doctors?
I want to know, in cases, class 2 cases, three class 2 cases, where it is subgingival. We do a core, after root canal we do a core and we will not be able to place the finish line on the two structure. So what's your take on that? How do you manage to give a finish line on the two structure in such cases?
You can't, if you don't have a tooth, how can you create a finish line on the tooth? It's impossible.
So
you can try to create a finish line on your post. What area you are doing there, interproximally, try to create a finish line on the post. Like how you show, I showed you in a metal
on
coping.
The core.
Yeah, on the core, on the margin.
So the
merge
core.
It with the interproximal margin of the other side, means buccal or lingual. Try to bring the finish line over the core.
Preferably evaluate the probing depth there. We should not be violating the biological bit. Because once that happens, the patient will forever have better.
What I found is, in such cases, I feel amalgam core is the best. Because amalgam being amalgam, it will not dissolve and it is very friendly with the jaw and it will help and it is easy to retract in such cases. And if you place the finish line on the amalgam core, it stays for a longer time and it's more sturdy. Instead of a composite where the bonding is a little weak in the gingival area and even with retraction, you won't be able to record that much in a composite, I feel it personally. So if amalgam core is in those areas, if you look like in a deep classroom, should be, you know,
yeah,
get a very good finish line.
See, amalgam is best metal gold standard. I don't think many of us are using. I don't think, maybe hardly 1 or 2 or 5% gold practitioners will be using amalgam.
Still
new old practitioners are using. That is what I'm telling you. No new practitioners use amalgam because it's a cumbersome procedure. You need time to do all that. But it is the best material. No material can replace amalgam.
Even the miracle
mix
also really nice.
No, miracle will sag. No, it will not have that
much. It is GIC based, no.
GIC
base. In fact, GIC is supposed to
okay,
be.
Okay, one question is for long standing extraction of the lower 6 which has already happened, and you have seen a 7 and the 5 which has drifted and that gives an inverted V. So, how do you manage that kind of space? Do you give just a 2 unit crown managing those spaces? Almost 3/4 space is closed. So, how do you, you know, fill that gap with an artificial process in the center, make it a 3 unit or give a 2 unit bridge only per set?
See, again depends on the space what is available. Okay, you are telling you have a view, but it is the amount of space. So if you have enough width for a pontic, you can go for a 3 unit. If the space is very less, then you can go for it.
So what is the amount of space we are looking at? Ideal space?
Ideal should be for pontic 7 to 8.
So anything less than that should be a 2 unit.
About less than 5, you can go for
2. You can go for non-rigid connectors.
I came across a study where you are using posteriorly to use ceramic, leading to TMD problems. What's your take on that? And so that's why the occlusal surface is being changed to gold, which is more softer and on the.
That money. Study is conducted on monolith crowns, not on the PDFM crowns.
Yes.
Because monolith is more harder. So that causes more of attrition of the upper and causes TMD issues.
What's your take on that? So should we go back to gold and softer metal then? Or should we stick to...
See, gold is best if you have to actually see a metal. Gold is the best material what you can use. Like how amalgam, gold is the best material. So most of the labs don't use NPG. Most of the labs don't do NPG work. Basically that is a hindrance for most of us. But if you use... Maybe most of them may not like the color of it. They may think it is, I don't like gold. They always prefer to use ceramic. Most of the patients prefer to use ceramic when they are not thinking of financial. So when you are doing, if you, no one will definitely have a interest, ki patient comes, you will not tell him we'll do gold crown or an NPG crown. No one, does anyone tell? That doesn't come to your mind because you're not into that kind of practice. So always think, you'll think least is metal, best is metal free. That is what you think. Now see, ceramic, you do a PFM crown, you do a metal free crown. Any ceramic always attracts the opposition. See, now coming to TMJ problem, see, maybe he may have TMJ problem, may not have. That again depends on what type of occlusion they are given, what type of error is there occlusally. We have to personally evaluate to actually come to a conclusion as what is the problem. So as you tell, 100% I agree that gold is best. Type 3 and type 4 is the best material what you can use for casting. See, even today post encore I sometimes prefer using any
kitchen. Okay, I have a few questions from the GDP doctors. The one question is, what is the best way to clean a de-cemented or a lead bonded sound crown which the clinician is planning to re-cement?
The best way to clean cement on which surface?
On the crown.
Sandblast. Best way to clean a crown is inner surface is sandblast. No other technique can be.
Okay, we have one more question. What exactly is NPG? Is it a precious solar?
It's not precious. NPG is not
precious.
Japanese.
Sorry, about NPG, we are discussing the other day.
NPG is nothing but Japanese gold.
NPG is not Japanese.
Exactly.
Okay, so what is NPG 2 then?
NPG, I know it's a non-precious gold alloy which is used in dentistry for making posts and also making single crowns they can use.
This lab does
it. I lost time.
No, we are discussing about NPG.
Yes.
The one of the case which was listed. So it was like alternate to gold alloy, that is. It cannot be a gold.
It doesn't contain gold, that's what we came to conclude. Yeah, it cannot contain gold.
If it contains gold, no one will do it for 200 bucks a day.